M. The Media Project.
Excuse me, do you mind if I join you?
Last words, Dr. Jones?
I like Ike.
Hello and welcome to the Mental Suppository. I'm Bret Herholtz.
I'm Andrew Shanley.
I'm Jamie Billings.
And welcoming back...
I'm Wayne Nevis.
And before we begin tonight's discussion, we have a new sponsor.
The Mental Suppository brought to you by Poor Decisions, America's favorite new board game. Roll the dice, pick a card, and see what hits the fan.
Got your girlfriend pregnant and her parents are less than pleased with you. Move three places.
Bummer! You just landed on drop out of community college and forced to be a night manager at Honey Farms.
Harsh, bruh.
Harsh indeed, bruh. And from the makers of Back Alley Operation... Horny, Horny Hippos, and Stab Me Elmo, Poor Decisions is a game that's not much fun for the entire family.
You took part in the Capitol riots? Roll the dice.
Go to jail.
Oh, but the guy dressed as a water buffalo seemed like a cool dude.
Wrong again. Everybody's a loser at Poor Decisions. Buy it today. You'll regret it. Poor Decisions by Mars.
Speaking of Poor Decisions, it's... I hear there's going to be a new Indiana Jones movie this year.
Yeah.
Great segue.
Thank you. And Andrew just reminded me today, it was 40 years ago that Raiders of the Lost Ark came out.
Yep. It makes you feel super old.
Yeah, June, I know.
1981. I don't know exactly the day that it came out, but obviously it was the big release from Lucasfilm.
I was still too young to remember it. Yeah. The one I actually ended up seeing in theaters was Temple of Doom.
My parents had seen
Raiders of the Lost Ark, and they thought, you know, it was a great...
Oh, it'll be great. So this movie, Temple of Doom, should be just as much fun, right?
I'll tell you what. It's like, it wasn't even the monkey brains or the bugs. It was when they ripped his heart out during the sacrifice.
Mom Shabai.
Yep, that's it. I lost my shit.
Yeah.
But then a year or so later, I ended up finally seeing Raiders of the Lost Ark, and it was just such a great film. And I can see, you know, it was like, you know, being older, you can see how, you know, Lucas and Spielberg added a lot of like their love for the old movie serials, yeah, like King Solomon's Mines, which we will talk about. That I think we should talk about that as well a little later.
We certainly will.
Oh yeah.
I would simply add that, especially when you talk about Spielberg and Lucas, this is like they were already hitting their mark and they were ready to roll.
That was the prime.
They were on fire.
Yeah. They were on fire. I mean, you had Star Wars,
Golden Boys,
E.T. Yep. You had the E.T. hadn't been released yet. That was 82.
Yeah, 1941. But we won't.
It's that area though. It's that whole area of time.
It's right at the pinnacle, the beginning of the 80s, and they were just on fire.
They were.
Here's also something else to note. Back then, the thought of the budgets for what they were making had to be very constrained. Had to be like,
no.
You're not spending $2,000 on a model. You're going to spend $20 on a model and figure out how to make it into a Millennium Falcon.
Yeah,
Nowadays, Popsicle because sticks. Everything is so CGI, mm-hmm, people like Michael Bay, again, don't get me wrong, I'm not putting Michael Bay down, but it's just people like Michael Bay, he cares more about the explosion than he cares about the storyline. Yeah. And you get to a point where like, okay, I get where the 16th explosion and the 23rd explosion come into play, but what are we watching here again?
Well, I mean, George Lucas, when he made Empire, there was a great documentary about the making of that film.
Mm.
And George Lucas has this very...
Was it the one that came out at the time the film came out that's like hosted by Mark Hamill?
I think it may have been.
But I might
have
seen that at the Spencer Library.
This amazing quote from George Lucas said, you know, a special effect is, you know, by itself is not a
special
very expensive...
Special effect is nothing without
exactly.
Story.
It's like, it's that quote that he says. And
you're going to need a story.
And if you don't have a good story behind a special effect, it's going to be boring. And when you take a look at Raiders of the Lost Ark, it was really one of those great nostalgic throwbacks. But
exactly, yeah,
that was one of the things that Spielberg and Lucas were able to do, is they were able to kind of capture that.
I didn't get that at the time, though. You know, it's like I didn't realize, you know, I was, you know, I knew of older films, but, you know, I didn't, you know, it wouldn't be until I was much older that, you know, you'd find out about all the old movie serials from the 30s and 40s and all the adventure serials and all that sort of stuff that ended up fueling, you know, George Lucas's imagination as a kid, where he, instead of wanting to, recreate that, create his own versions of it. Yeah,
but that's what shows you how that certain style has been able to transcend all generations, because we didn't know about those serials and those action, yeah,
we
you know,
we
1940s.
Found out about them later.
We watched Indiana Jones, and we knew there was something about it that was that the action got us. Yeah, it was something that was timeless about the guy himself.
There was so much action in that movie.
And they weren't like deeply philosophical movies, and that was not a bad thing. Mm-hmm. They were fun movies. You know, Harrison Ford's, you know, sort of his character just being so, you know, a bit snarky, a bit, you know, a bit cocksure. It just, that's what made the characters so likable. I mean, just the whole,
that's,
and even the
right.
scene.
I'm a cocksman.
You sure are,
well,
Harrison. You
actually,
sure
that's an are. interesting point you make. That a lot of characters who are made today of people of super intelligence. Give an example: The Big Bang Theory. Can I mention other shows on this?
Sure.
Okay, I just want to make sure I get sued. Big Bang Theory.
Will.
Sheldon Cooper, super smart, not likable. Why? Because he's obnoxious. He's rude. He's
arrogant.
Thank you. Indiana Jones gave off that same intelligence, but not with the arrogance. He actually made you want, you're going to teach me something? That's awesome. Please continue.
Charm.
What was everybody's favorite scene from Raiders? Just out of curiosity.
For me, it has to actually do something when I was younger, because I remember being a kid and renting Indiana Jones from Spencer Furniture.
Oh, yes.
Coming home on a Saturday night, my mom and dad were going out for their Saturday night dinner, and I was left with the babysitter, and the babysitter was like, you're going to let him watch this? All right, cool. And I remember getting up to the scene where the propeller was coming right behind the guy.
Oh, gosh.
And in my 5-year-old mind, I was thinking, like, and I just remember jumping behind my dad's chair, so I didn't, and you know, and the guy gets chopped up, and then I peek around the corner and just see the little bit of blood just going up there. But then,
it
terrified the hell on me. But then I remember being older and a few years older, and be like, oh, I gotta be brave. I want to see what this is. And I remember watching it and being like, wow, I was afraid of nothing, because it doesn't even show anything.
Actually, that's the great part.
I was about to mention the exact same thing.
I was just going to get to is that because they didn't show everything, they made you think it so much that it put this fear in me for years and years and years.
I know.
Yeah.
But that's one of the things that makes Lucas and Spielberg and all the others great actors and directors and movie makers, because they think like that. They think, we don't have to shock the audience. We just have to bring them up to that certain point and then let their imaginations take over.
What was your favorite scene?
Mine was the very end when...
I'm just getting everybody fat man rags.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mine was the scene when the cask, the Ark is opened and all hell breaks loose and you see all the everything bad happening. Melting guy.
Oh, gosh.
So for me,
the melting or exploding.
For me, it was. I mean, like him. For you, it was the propeller blade that freaked you out. For me, it was the melting, because my parents don't have boundaries. I went and saw Alien when I was 6.
Wow.
All right. So, it was one of those things where it's like my parents didn't quite have that switch to say, "Well, it's an R-rated movie, and he's 6 years old. He should be fine." So when I saw Raiders of the Lost Ark for the first time, which was actually in the movie theaters, the propeller scene, I was floored on that, because the fact that they cut away when I was expecting the gore to actually happen.
Yeah.
And I thought, that was brilliant. Like you said, it reminded me of the old serials. But when the guy starts melting, I lost my shit. It took me a while to get past that scene. Like, I'd watch that movie and be, okay, can we fast forward past this part of it?
Actually,
it was just so gory.
It wasn't even when the Angel of Death had the demonic face. It was actually the very beautiful face when I was a kid that scared me.
That was
For years, I didn't know who the actress was, and I had to look it up just to see that it was actually a real person.
And like also the effect of how they did the angel is basically just filming this woman underwater. And then
that's
and
brilliant.
That makes her,
I did not know that. That is
makes
cool.
Makes her hair kind of flow. Yes. Like that, and yep. That's why her gown kind
gown,
of had that
yeah.
flow.
Actually, the first time I ever saw that scene wasn't in the film. I actually borrowed from the school library. They had a Raiders of the Lost Ark comic book.
Oh, really?
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah.
So this, I actually.
The story
oh,
book.
I remember the comic
the books
that
tape?
Came out.
No, it wasn't the books on tape.
It was
actually
the
a Marvel
book.
Comic.
Yeah.
Yeah, they would have the
comic. Was it a comic? Of the story,
yes.
Or was it like a behind the scenes of
no,
how
no,
it
no,
was,
no, it
like
a, it was an adaptation.
Like
of
back
story.
In the day,
gotcha,
like
gotcha.
Oh man, what was one that I had? I remember there was a movie that came out.
I don't remember.
I got
one
the comic.
Total Recall. They had
oh,
a whole
no,
bunch
no, no, no. It was Aliens. It was. Yep. It was Aliens before they did the
Escape from L.A.
Before they did the re-release.
Escape from L.A. They did a comic for that.
This comic for Aliens had all the scenes that they had filmed, but never put in the theatrical cut.
Oh, well, that was interesting.
Until recently.
Because,
yeah. Like, no, they now have like
Newt's parents getting killed and everything.
Well, yep.
It's interesting you mentioned scenes that weren't in because there was a part in the Raiders comic where when Indy says, you know, don't look at the Ark, Marion, shut your eyes. They have her say in the comic, but it looks so beautiful. Yeah. She ends up shutting her eyes, but you know, it's one of those things.
Oh, okay.
I thought it was actually much better in the movie because she basically. Listen, you know,
she listened to
she
Indy.
Can't, you know, it's obvious she can't stand him because he was kind of a bastard to her in the past. But when it came to that point when she knows he's being serious, he goes, Marion, shut your eyes. Don't look at the Ark. And she immediately shuts her eyes. And that's what kind of made me miss Karen Allen in the second movie, besides you had to listen to Kate Capshaw screaming.
Well, yes, but if you also notice that the second movie, Temple
Wait,
of Doom,
was
before.
It Kate Capshaw? Was that the actress?
Yeah, Kate Capshaw. Yeah,
thank you.
It's before Raiders of the Lost Ark. Temple of Doom is actually a precursor
yep.
to
That's right.
Raiders of the Lost Ark, so it makes sense for her not to be there,
yeah.
but she could have easily have been in the
oh, yeah,
third
good
one.
Point. Yeah. But still, her Willy was annoying.
Yeah.
Well, no, here's also another thing. I like your point, but I have to
Jesus
disagree with it,
Willy.
Is the fact that she loved him.
Yeah.
And yes, she hated him because he dumped her and because, you know, let's be honest, the story is of a professor having sex with one of his students and then that goes badly. I'm like, seriously, how could that possibly go bad?
Oh, exactly. I know.
Exactly.
But after her place burns down and she says, you know, I'm your goddamn partner.
Yep.
From that point on, she does do what he tells
yeah.
her. She does follow his lead.
Yeah.
I think at that point she accepts that it's an adventure for her and she's
That's
she's
a good
all
point.
For
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
But the thing that gets me on the shut your eyes, I don't have a problem with her not listening to him or listening to him. I have an issue with him. Shut your eyes, Miriam. I wonder her say, why? Tell me why I have to shut my eyes. Where in this story did you and I have a conversation that shutting my eyes was going to save my life from this?
Well, I suppose they just gotten captured by Nazis. So at that point, you know, it's like one of these things. They're doing something really stupid, you know?
Yeah.
And
I mean, honestly, there's the whole movie, honestly, if you wanted to talk about a perfect action film of the 1980s, Raiders is it.
Mm-hmm.
But if I had to pick any scene that really kind of defined what Raiders was, it's the truck chase. So if you take a look at action sequences of all major motion pictures in the last 40 years, you take a look at how the truck chase is set up, how he has to get on the truck. He rides the horse to get on the truck. Then he's getting shot at by the bad guys. Then the bad guys who are in the truck get out of the truck. He has to fight the bad guys and knock them off the truck. And then he has to fight with the guy that's driving the truck. He gets knocked underneath the truck. He gets dragged by the truck. He gets back on the truck. Then he's got to deal with, like, you know, knocking the guy back out of the truck. You know, all kinds of chaos.
Yeah.
The stakes of that action sequence. And every single point, it keeps on going. It keeps on elevating. Yeah,
but in a good way.
And that's the thing that a lot of action sequences today do not have. It's just like when you look at John Wick. I like John Wick movies. The problem with the John Wick movies is it's the same fight.
Same fight in the same movie, really.
Same yeah. fight. Every single fight is the exact same. It doesn't raise the stakes. It, you know, John Wick is basically on God mode.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with Indy, he gets shot.
And you see that in the scene when he's on the what was he on
the he's
boat?
On the cruise
boat.
Ship.
The
yep.
cruise ship, and he's taking off his.
He gets shot.
It's not the years.
He
it's
gets
mileage.
Dragged. He's like, you know, he's actually dealing with real injuries in real time as the thing's going on. So he may be perfect at the beginning, but at the end, he's just like, oh man, I need to recharge. You know, And that's the thing about the truck chase is that it's one of the best action sequences in that in the history of action sequences.
Also about the truck chase was how it was magnificently filmed.
Exactly.
A lot of the techniques that Spielberg used that he picked up when he was filming the low-budget Duel was he learned that if you put the camera really low down to the ground, you don't really have to go that fast in order to make everything seem like you're going fast.
Exactly.
So Indiana Jones, when he's on the front of the hood of the truck and the camera's really low down beneath them, they're only doing like 25 miles an hour, 30 miles an hour. But you feel the intensity that they're going much faster.
Exactly.
Right? It's all just the brilliance of how they filmed that entire chase scene.
Add to that that brilliant score from John Williams.
Yes.
You know, the editing of that whole situation with all the action sequences with, like, you know, the German car flying off the cliff and, like, you know, them going through a marketplace and all the other things that they were doing for that scene. It's one of, I think, one of the best action sequences.
Like the music point when it opens up, when he's Indiana Jones is on the horse and you hear the triumphant dun da 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 as he's riding the horse and he looks down on them and it suddenly takes that somber bum, and then as Indiana Jones's horse is going down the hill it goes bump bump bump. It does the march almost in tune with how the horse is going.
It goes along with the old serials.
Everything
was in the music and the serials.
It adds the tension and adds everything. So that whole it's like a 10-minute action sequence, but you do not get bored from it.
You don't.
You can't get that from action movies today.
Right. What about you, Bret? What was the thing that made you, that stick out for you for Indiana Jones?
Actually, it's funny. There's a few scenes I really enjoyed. The one was actually when he was down the Well of Souls. Maybe it wasn't when he was in the Well of Souls, but when he put the thing on
the map room.
I'm sorry. The map room. Yes,
where he puts the staff in
the
hole.
That's what I was thinking.
Map room.
That was my favorite scene when he puts it down, and all of a sudden the sun beam goes right through it. As a kid, I always liked it. And again, it's all about the music in the scene.
It could have been
a really boring scene, but the way the music builds up and up and up, you just immediately get drawn into it. And especially like you see Harrison Ford's facial expressions as he realizes, I know where it is.
You know, the whole John Williams score is just such a brilliant character in that film.
It really is.
Yeah.
And the other favorite scene I have to say that I really liked was Bad Date.
Right before you guys showed up, Andy and I we recreated that scene, like down to the song.
That's awesome.
I am the Sultan of the Sea. I am the ruler of the Bad Date.
I mean, honestly,
John Rhys-Davies.
Yep. Yeah. Beautiful. I mean, every single person.
Alfred Molina.
Yeah.
That's right.
That was like his first acting role.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
He has a bit part in the beginning of the movie, and he gets his ass killed.
Stupido.
Yeah.
But at least he gets to speak. I mean, the guy who was with him didn't even get to say a word.
I know.
No, I think he said something like, the poison is still fresh, like 2 days behind. You know, or something like that.
No, Molina says that.
Still fresh.
Yep.
2 days. They are following us.
Don't ask me how I know that.
Oh. I won't ask. Don't worry about it.
So that brings us into discussions about Temple of Doom, which has its own mixed reactions, really, because there are parts of the movie that I still enjoy quite a bit.
The problem with it was I think they just tried to go too dark. And even later on, I think Spielberg and Lucas said they were going through a really bad patch in their lives, and Temple of Doom kind of reflected that. But I think they were trying to be a little too, almost like a little too much. Whereas, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark, it had a dark moments, but it still had a lightheartedness to it. Whereas Temple of the Doom was just really, it was just like really dark and gloomy, and it didn't have that same fun.
I still enjoyed the whole beginning sequence in Club Obi-Wan.
Yes. Also, there was also the whole thing with the underground truck. You know, when they were
the cart,
the cart.
Thank you.
Yeah. No time for love, Dr. Jones.
Oh,
I loved that.
See, that's actually, I find funny, you're seeing as dark. I didn't really see Temple of Doom as dark.
Well,
I saw it more as comedic. I saw it more as designed for kids.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, granted, the whole temple scene with the heart and everything. Yeah.
This is a movie that ended up earning creating the first PG-13.
Yeah. The first PG-13 rating came.
This had a snake being cut open to reveal more little snakes.
Right, but if you...
Let's eat some chilled monkey brains.
If you look at all the fight sequences...
What? You're not hungry? You're not going to eat that beetle? That was disgusting. And you think this is for kids?
Okay, but here's the thing.
I'll give you a chance
I can't wait for the Happy Meal. Yeah.
It's in the shape of a monkey face.
If you look at the fight scenes, if you look at the cart chase, if you look at any instance where Indy has to do something heroic, it is all done in a form of comedic fashion. If you pay attention to the cart scene, you really don't get to notice this until you see like the behind the scenes, which I, for one, do not like behind the scenes. It takes away from the magic of the movie. I like to be surprised. But I did watch the behind the scenes of Temple of Doom, and the Temple of Doom shows how the cart scenes were done with these little miniatures back and forth. And I cannot not stop seeing that now every time I see that movie.
So sort of like when you see someone do a stunt, like
or a magic trick.
In Jurassic Park, when Laura Dern's character had to jump over a stump, it was quite obvious that it was a stunt woman because it had a bad hair. And then, and now every time I see that, I'm like, there's the stunt woman.
And she's 5'7", and Laura Dern's 6'2". So that kind of stuck out too.
Exactly. With Temple of Doom, obviously, it was definitely, I think, I agree with him to a certain point, but I don't think that they translated the product to what they needed to do. I mean, especially with you had Short Round and they had all the kids, you know. But those slavery scenes with those kids.
That was brutal.
Yeah. Those kids are getting whipped. Those kids are getting beat.
And now they work for Disney.
Okay, sorry. But now here's actually a very interesting question. The scenes where the kids are getting beat, where they're getting destroyed and whatnot and forced to work and all that. Now, in order for the realism of the story to come into play, we have to see stuff like that.
Exactly.
They have to show it. Well, so you can't sugarcoat it.
No.
It has to look, I mean, it doesn't matter what the story is. I mean, if you're looking back at the serials of the 30s and the 40s, when you saw in those shows people being brutalized and people being mistreated, they had to actually show that. Yes, this is a serial. It's a kid show. Hopalong Cassidy. I'm going to give Hopalong Cassidy a good example because the man, shut up. If you watch the show,
let's turn on an older tube TV, black and white.
It's a good thing no one can see this. If you looked at the show, he kind of was a little bit like Indiana Jones, where he was a no-nonsense guy. He didn't take any guff. He used his brains to figure things out. And it was fun for kids, but they still had to show the downside. They still had to show the drudgery. They had to show the Indians being mistreated for that particular series. Now, in this movie for Temple of Doom, if they didn't show that kind of mistreatment for the kids, again, it's at that level that just wouldn't make it believable anymore.
You make some really good points. I just still don't like Temple of Doom.
I
mean,
I would simply say I love that movie. I love all the movies except for, I mean, obviously we'll talk about Crystal Skull later.
Oh, cool.
But when it came to Temple of Doom, it was just another opportunity to kind of get into that character, and it was a different flavor. You know, because this wasn't the Indiana Jones of "It Belongs in a Museum." This is the Indiana Jones of "Fortune and Glory." You know, that was the thing.
The fortune and glory.
Remember? Yeah, but the fortune and glory was what she was seeking. He wasn't. He was doing the right thing by trying to send the stone back to the village.
Yeah, and that was kind of a character development. It was like an arc at the end of the film. He gives that one stone back, spoiler alert. And
the film came out in 1983. I don't think we need spoiler alerts anymore. But, and if people feel spoiled by it, get over it.
So one of the things that is that you saw a change from his original opening and what he was into to the end of the film, where he's with Willie Scott, obviously does the whole whip, whip rap thing, which
lady only
a little bit of misogynistic
ladies
attitude
only
there.
Ladies only in movie because she humping director.
When she was dating the director at the time,
she was.
Yep, she was.
Well, to be fair, Spielberg, I think, was going through a really bad divorce at that time anyway, so,
Hey, fun side to the story.
So the fact, actually, you know, the fact if he ends up with the leading lady, good for him.
Well, yeah. Actually, and to your point, the fun side of the story is, like you're pointing out, of the character development from Temple of Doom, which technically translates to Raiders of the Lost Ark. They did the exact same thing in The Last Crusade,
yes,
by bringing a very young Indy for us to see that.
That was really cool.
Well done to show, yep, even back in the day, he was always with that same attitude. This belongs in a museum.
And it's really sad because River Phoenix at that young age was a really good actor.
He did pretty good on Indiana Jones.
He did a good Harrison.
Jones, yeah.
He was good as a young Indy.
He was really great.
Yeah. With his fat Boy Scout sidekick.
The bugle friend guy. Yeah.
Gosh, I wanted to push
I the got the sheriff.
I brought the sheriff.
Did they have Twinkies back then? Because
he
might have had them.
He clearly never missed a meal. But one of the things
he had a lot of caramel cowtails at that time. Lots of them.
He was at his father owned the dime store candy section of the five and dime.
He ate the dime store candy section.
He ate the dime store.
But with Temple of Doom, obviously, you know, it was like a product. It feels like it was partially kids' show. One of the best scenes in the movie, obviously, is the mine car chase.
Yeah,
and
that's
again,
what I remember.
Similar to the truck chase, it kind of follows that formula. It's not as long, but it follows that formula. It's that big end of the film that actually has that.
Right.
And that really kind of blows people away.
And the other aspect of the kids aspect, remember the scene when Indy gets out of his mental state of being controlled? And then he starts beating up on the guy. And they show Short Round on a ledge above him doing the exact same thing to the prince. Like, they're both fighting like on tandem, punch by punch.
Yep.
Again, you're looking at how old did you say Short Round was? 12, 13?
Maybe.
This was like pre-Goonies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he was like 12 or 13.
12 or 13. All right. So you got a 12 or 13-year-old beating the shit out of another 12 or 13-year-old, and we're all loving it. We're all seeing that. It's like, yeah, this is for kids. Woo!
You're beating up the bully.
Yes, you're beating up. And that's the thing. That's the difference. You got the good guy beating up on the bully. You don't have just some random person beating up on some random person. It's not just violence for violence's sake.
Exactly. Right. Well, the other things to actually add to that is that Jackie Chan was one of the people who was doing the fight.
I never knew that.
I did not know that either. This is the first time I'm hearing this.
Yeah,
awesome.
He was
probably did.
Was he like a stunt coordinator?
Yeah, he was a fight choreographer. This is like when
I didn't know this.
Yeah, this is all cool.
He was like in the early 80s. Hollywood is like he was one of the biggest draws of Hong Kong cinema at the time.
Yeah.
That must have been around Cannonball Run time.
Yeah, that was when Cannonball Run was around. Mm. Jackie Chan tried to make a movie called The Protector.
Yes.
With him in it, and they did a whole action movie with him. And they said, "Hey, listen, he's one of the biggest, you know, kung fu guys in China right now. We need him for an action film. Hey, Spielberg brought him in." And so that's where he worked with a lot of the martial arts with the kid, especially.
If there was a guy that was like a Buster Keaton for our generation, it was Jackie Chan. This was a guy who did his own stunts, broke a lot of bones.
That's actually an interesting point. Yeah. There's at least three movies that he's been in where the ending credits, they show clips and they show him in a leg brace or an arm brace or something that he hurt during the filming. But he's like, no, keep going.
It ends with a little thumbs up.
Yeah.
No, that guy's incredible.
But another interesting thing also about Jackie Chan is that he is kind of like the Leslie Nielsen of China. He started his acting career serious, like Bruce Lee with the...
Operatic and stuff.
Not necessarily operatic, but his characters were stern. Yes. His fighting scenes were vicious. He may have been doing the whole bouncing through hoops and everything like that, but because he was so good at it. But he still did it with a serious look. It's only when he started making movies like Rumble in the Bronx... Mr. Nice Guy. Yeah. Like late 80s, early 90s, when he started realizing, I can do this and make fun of it. In which case, that brought him a whole new set of audience.
And still be brilliant at it, too. Yeah.
And he was. If you got to look at the outtakes just to see how much involved he was to do these scenes.
However old he is now, he's probably could do better than I can at my age.
I mean,
honest to goodness.
Jackie Chan actually started out on Enter the Dragon. As one of the bad guys.
Wasn't Chuck Norris also in one of the?
He was in Game of Death.
That's Game of Death. Okay.
And no, Chuck Norris was also in.
He was in two movies. He was in Game of Death, and they reused his scenes from that movie to do Game of Death like it was an acting scene.
That's right. And, you know, when Jackie Chan was working with him, he's just one of the guys that gets beat up and thrown aside. Bruce accidentally hurt him a little bit. And so Bruce was like, I'm really sorry, but from now on, I'm going to be working with you on all the movies that I'm going to be doing after this one. And then he died.
Yeah, but because he saw that Jackie Chan could take the punch and still act potential. Like he was supposed to.
Exactly.
That's the thing. I mean, if you can see, I think it's Shanghai Noon. I want to say it's Shanghai Noon, but there is a scene in the movie where you see him get hurt. Like he does a scene and it doesn't quite go exactly as it's supposed to.
Yeah.
And he gets hurt, but he keeps going. He keeps doing the scene. I'm like, he had to be like, oh my God, I'm in some serious pain right now. But he still kept acting.
But getting back to Temple of Doom, I mean, it just goes to show that this level of, and this is one of the things about 80s movies in general, is that when you had a studio greenlight a movie that said, okay, we need our best director, our best writer, our best actors, our best choreographers, our best special effects people. Let's get them all together on this one project. And everybody worked together. It wasn't like this piecemeal thing that you see nowadays out of action movies or anything else like that where it's a video game, you know?
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Where they come up with a release date before they even finish the script. You know, it was like release it when it's finished. And that was one of the things about 80s movies, especially Temple of Doom or any other 80s movie like that. It was back then it was about get it done right.
It didn't feel rushed.
Exactly.
And you think about with when they finally did Last Crusade, that could have gone really badly and that could have tanked because I think in their minds they wanted to go back in the opposite direction, do something that was a little more lighthearted and a little closer to the
campy.
Campy. A little bit, you know, closer to the feel of Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Yeah.
And a little bit campy, and I like campy, and it worked for this. It worked for the third film. It felt like they should have ended it on that film. It just felt like a really nice ending.
I think honestly this is a good transition to go right into Last Crusade then. But I remember when I saw that movie in the theater, I was with my friends at camp and we just went to see it and I was just like blown away, like going, oh my God, this is like the best movie of the year. And that in 89, that was when that movie came out. That was a new movie that came out in the summer of like Batman.
Right.
Lethal Weapon 2.
Well, it was like a couple of years of that. You had movies like Who Framed Roger Rabbit, you had Beetlejuice, you had 85 Pee-wee's Big Adventure. You had like this slew of movies that came out in a very finite part of time. That
and of course,
really
one of my favorite
movies
from the 1989 UHF.
Oh, yeah. Which had a great homage to Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Yep.
just the scene where the guy sneaks out of the cave and he gets hit by the train.
We have to go.
And then,
no.
And just the way Weird Al just kind of looks over at him. That was just such a great scene. And then the boulder chasing him through all like the stock footage.
I just kind of thought that Last Crusade was just a little awkward. I think especially the whole so son, did you know that I banged her too?
I didn't think about that at the time, but even now I don't mind because it's like.
I remember being a kid and be like, wait, what? Did they both?
It wasn't banged her? It wasn't years later till I realized.
I shagged her long and hard.
The whole thing of she talks in her sleep.
That's what made me be like, wait, how did he know that? Oh.
And you know what?
The looks they gave each other. It's like, so subtle.
Well, wouldn't you? You seen her.
But you could tell, like, Spielberg and Lucas. James Bond fans, Sean Connery, yeah. James Bond.
Yeah,
of course.
Banging the
Allison
woman.
Duty, the girl who plays Elsa in the movie, was actually a Bond girl in View to a Kill.
I thought she was gorgeous in the movie.
Oh, God, yeah.
I thought that was Olivia Adabo.
No, she was one of the subtle. No, that was View to a Kill had Grace.
A View to a Kill.
Grace
no,
Slick.
A View to a Kill was
no,
with
Grace Slick.
No, you're right. Roger Moore, Grace Slick.
No, Grace Slick.
Grace
is,
that's just that's
Grace Jones. Thank you.
That's what's her name? That's Lang, the one that supposedly died but didn't die.
Yeah.
Katie Lang?
No. Tanya Roberts. Roberts was the Bond girl in View to a Kill.
She passed away.
Are we sure about that?
Allison Duty was one of
Are we sure?
Well, we're not doing a conspiracy theory show, but...
But Allison Duty was one of the bad girls who was hanging out with
but that
Grace
was a,
Jones.
That was a great plot point to Last Crusade, is the fact that, you know, he doesn't get the girl. She ends up turning out to be, you know...
Evil.
Yeah, working with the Nazis. Yep. And it was like, that was kind of a nice little... And the whole time, you know... He's saying, you know, oh, let her. They're not going to shoot her. Let her. And he, you know, Indiana Jones being, you know, a good guy and thinking he's doing the right thing, you know, throws the gun down. And she says, but you should have listened
to you. But you should have, yeah.
And but you should have listened to your father.
And then it's like at that point, you know,
bump, bump, bump.
Indiana Jones is just looking at her like, oh, fuck you.
But there's also an interesting aspect of that. I never really considered her evil. Yes, she worked for the Nazis, but then what's the difference between...
She was just opportunistic.
There you go.
Yeah. Opportunistic. Like, what's the difference between anyone who works for the CIA or NSA today? You know, the same mentality. She saw a ancient relic that she just couldn't let go. It was a little red button, and she was a Keddie, and she had to touch it.
I'll be honest, my favorite character in Indiana Jones, who was a character that showed up in Raiders of the Lost Ark, was Marcus Brody, who didn't have many lines in the first one, but just sort of... became a great sidekick in the last one, and he was portrayed by, you know, actor Delholm Elliott, who was just one of these British actors who'd kind of been in just about everything, but at the same time, you know, it's like this was kind of, I feel like this was like the first film, you know, you kind of noticed him. It's like, you know, does anybody speak any English?
Does anybody speak English?
How about ancient Greek? Anyone?
So just having that, like, that group of actors, you know, you had Sean Connery, you had Harrison Ford, you had John Rhys Davies, you had Delholm, you know, those actors as the leads, you know.
Well, the thing about it was also, it was such a great ensemble cast.
Yes.
It was like getting the band back together.
Yeah. And I mean, he didn't have a really big part in Raiders. He was just kind of a character who worked with Indiana Jones. But,
it's like but nothing it was a you've significant ever gone part. Up to before.
Exactly.
Yeah. And actually, that's a hallmark of a good actor.
Yeah.
Is that, can you make more of an impression with what little you have?
Right.
There was that great scene from Raiders that I always
feel like I'm talking loud enough when I don't get close.
There's that great scene from Raiders when they were looking at, you know, talk about the Ark of the Covenant, and somebody said, my God. And he's like, yes, and I'm sure that's what the Egyptians said. And it was just that great little, like, throwaway line. But, you know, it's like a lesser actor wouldn't have done it as well, but he just sort of, you know, said it in a way that just, you know, made it stick in your mind and just make it funny.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, the subtle humor of Raiders of the Lost, of Last Crusade is brilliant. And again, when you go and look at the story, the action sequences, they hold up. They really do.
Another great actor in that, playing the villain, Julian Glover, who had played a lot.
The boss, the one who started all of this.
The one who sent Indy on the track. But he'd been in a lot of, like, he'd been like one of these actors who'd been in a lot of British television, a lot of film, a lot of Doctor Who. He was also
in James Bond.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For Your Eyes Only.
Exactly.
He was just recently, I think, in Game of Thrones.
Yeah. I mean, they were just an these are classic actors. They're classically trained. They got it all down.
That's a director and a producer that understands the people they want to hire too.
Exactly. And that was I think, again, you got Spielberg in the 80s, he was like the guy. And all the other products that he had worked on, you know, from Raiders of the Lost Ark to even just stuff that he produced like Poltergeist and Back to the Future. I mean, he owned the 80s.
Again, around the table, favorite scene from Last Crusade. Mine was actually the one in the biplane when Sean Connery shoots the back of the thing. Goes, son, I'm sorry.
They got us.
Yeah. I don't know, just the way he played that character, because he wasn't trying to play it super suave like James Bond. He was, you know, he was playing it for laughs. He was, you know, basically, you know, Indies, you know.
That's kind of what I enjoyed about Sean Connery taking that character, is that he was like, okay, I'm a little bit older now, so I'm going to...
And the strange thing is, he wasn't that much older than Harrison Ford.
No, he
that's
wasn't.
Strange, yeah.
Yep, go around.
My favorite, God's sakes, there's got to be the scene where right after they land the plane and they're getting chased by the car, and they go on the beach, and you know, there's a Messerschmitt coming right at him, and it's about to strafe the crap out of him, and he just like grabs his umbrella.
What I like is the look that he gives right, like when he has the spark of the idea. You know what I'm talking about?
I know exactly.
Yes.
What, yeah.
It almost looks like he has the spark of the idea of, well, if I do this, they'll all fly. I love that part.
And, yeah. And it works. And, like, you know, just that bewilderment, like, Indiana Jones has. He's like, I can't believe that happened.
I can't believe that worked.
I think my favorite scene from that was just the gimmick when they were tied up.
Yeah, I think
that whole scene with them being tied up, first of all, and then the fire going... and then it gets giant. But then how they scurry themselves into the fire pit.
The revolving.
And then they just do the revolve around and, like, you know, they just look at the calmly looking and,
Allah!
Yes. and they just start, you know, hit the button and they go firing shoots at them. And, oh, I don't know. I really like that scene.
I think the scene also was perfect when the fact that they both look at her and smile, and she smiles back just before screaming.
Right. Yeah.
Alarm!
Such great comedic
timing. What
about
you?
For me, I think the best scene was the end, not the end of the movie, but the end of the tank scene. The tank goes over, and they think Indy goes over, and they're all like, you know, kind of giving their little bit of mourning for him until he shows up, and you just see him looking, and he's just like...
Yeah, he's like,
what are you guys looking at?
But he's so exhausted, and everyone's just like, once they realize he's alive, he's like, okay, don't forget what we just said. Let's go to work.
Yeah, and he plops down.
And the hat slowly rolls to him.
Because you thought he'd lost it, and then it just said, there it is.
Yep.
Hold on.
Theme music. We need some theme music.
Okay, yeah, I can do a theme. Yeah. Here's the theme.
Oh man, I just told that. That brings me back because my dad recorded Star Wars off of HBO.
Yep.
On VHS, and this is what we would listen to.
And this is how it opened
every single time we watched Star Wars. Was this theme?
Wait, right here.
Feature presentation.
Yep.
And now your feature presentation, motherfuckers.
Oh, nice.
Stop what you're doing and listen.
I'm not listening to you. You're crazy.
I also listen too much.
No, you didn't hear me. You listening, but you didn't hear me.
All right, let's try to play a game of Stump Andrew.
Okay.
Oh, gosh.
Let's do this.
Let's do it.
All right, so I'm going to go through just a quick couple ones here. Andy, here's your... It's a comedy.
Comedy.
That's your clue.
Ford, we just needed to be held.
You got the bonus plan.
I know
what
it is.
What is that movie?
Oh my God, it's a great movie.
I might know this.
What? Is it racking in your brain? Do you need to hear it again?
Can I say another line from it?
Nope. You only get one.
Okay. Hit me again.
All right, ready?
Ford, we just needed to be held.
You got the bonus plan.
Why am I thinking Caddyshack?
I think I know this one.
Nope.
Let us know when you're out.
I'm out.
You give it up. All right, Bret.
The Adventures of Ford Fairlane.
Yes.
Oh! Yep.
I've actually never seen the film, but when he said Ford.
Oh my God, that's a great
all
movie.
All I heard was Andrew Dice Clay's voice.
Yeah.
I'm a douchebag.
I was in school.
That's a funny movie.
I was in school, and all the kids would be like, Andrew Dice Clay would be like, "Hey, what's your name, Dice?" And I'm like, "No."
All right. How about this? Since we were talking about action movies from the '80s. How about this one? If you think you're good on action movie in the 80s, you think you're good?
I think I got it.
Yeah.
You're a funny guy, Sully. I like you. That's why I'm going to kill you last.
Commando.
Good job, dude. Without even thinking twice, he looked over at me.
I've got to let you know, Sully, this is my week off.
As he holds him out, yeah. Let me see if I could find anything else that could probably stump this boy. Ah, let's go to comedy.
Okay. Com-
Why do I sound like I was like from some like weird Midwestern comedy? Yeah.
Comedy. Yeah, we're listening to the comedy.
Let's do some comedy. All right, so this is your clue from a comedy movie.
Now, ping pong, or as the Chinese say, ping pong.
That would be Balls of Fury.
Yes. Okay. Good man. Good man. So far, he's good.
All right. I don't know if we can actually stump this guy. I don't know if we can stump Andrew.
On the first one.
Yeah, that was pretty obscure, though.
Yeah.
Fort Fairlane wasn't very popular when it came out.
No, it wasn't.
What? All right.
Oh, you know, it wasn't. He's right about that, but it's still a good movie.
I got one that I'm going to specifically throw at Bret.
Okay.
Volkswagen.
Oh.
Volkswagen.
Sounds like Adam Sandler.
Volkswagen.
Volkswagen.
Is it an Adam Sandler film or?
Yes.
Which?
It sounds like him.
Yeah. Do you know Andrew?
Is that Little Nicky?
Nope.
Is it Billy Madison?
Nope. Strike two.
Oh.
Wait, he's got the next one.
Oh, I get the next one. What's that movie? Happy Gilmore.
There it is.
Oh.
Happy Gilmore. Yeah.
That was actually my first thought.
Okay.
It's been years since I've seen Happy Gilmore. For whatever reason, it sounded like Billy Madison.
Ding.
As opposed
to every other Adam Sandler movie.
Oh, God,
like
yeah.
Billy Madison.
Yes, every, yeah.
That's why Happy Madison is the named after the best movies he ever made.
So this one is a toss-up. See who can answer it the quickest first. Ready?
Yep.
What the hell are you doing?
Ghostbusters!
Bret came first.
Sorry, ma'am. We thought you were somebody else.
That's not a bad idea. Let's do the full out. Who can call it first? So far, Bret is in the lead.
Really? All right. So I don't know. Andrew, you got a couple, didn't you?
Oh yeah, but you did pretty good too.
Okay.
All right. Ready? Let's do another all out. You're involved. Ready? Okay. Everybody. This is a comedy movie. Your clue is comedy.
I think we've established that caca caca and tookie tookie don't work.
Evolution.
There you go.
Oh gosh, I just watched that.
Caca caca.
That was fantastic.
That was actually
tookie tookie.
I actually liked that movie.
There's always time for lubricant.
Take the leg.
All right, do we have time for maybe one or two more?
Go for it.
All right, let's do. All right, we could probably do another one. All right, let's do another comedy movie. And since we're on a swing with comedy movies here, let's do another open round. Everybody in?
Pardon my French, but you're an asshole.
Ferris Bueller.
There you go.
Good one.
You like that?
I did like that.
You just
one.
Like the way he sounds.
Pardon my French, but you're an asshole.
Don't think you're. Just remember who you're dealing with.
Bueller.
Ferris Bueller.
Why'd you kick me? Wear your brains. Why'd you kick me? Wear your brains.
Yes. Yes. All right. So let's do another comedy. Yeah. All right.
Sure.
Open round. Everybody again.
Ow, my pancreas.
Oh, God. Was that Encino Man?
Yes.
Oh, Bret.
I was going to say son-in-law first.
No, nope, Bret got it. Yeah. Yep.
No, that's...
My pancreas.
Fuck you, Pauly Shore.
I think I got a bunch of let's do another comedy.
Yes,
here.
Let's do that.
All right.
I hadn't seen a body put together like that since I'd solved the case of the murdered girl with the big tits.
Nope.
What?
Not the Naked Gun.
Oh, it's not.
Frankenhooker?
Nope.
Play it again.
I hadn't seen a body put together like that since I'd solved the case of the murdered girl with the big tits.
Loaded weapon?
No.
Nope. Think of who's saying the line.
It's Leslie Nielsen, right?
No, it's not Leslie Nielsen.
That's not Leslie Nielsen.
It almost sounds like Harrison Ford.
I hadn't seen a body put together like that since I'd solved the case of the murdered girl with the big tits.
Dead men don't wear plaid.
Steve Martin.
Nice.
Steve Martin.
Yeah, because as soon as you played it the third time, you listen
Griffin.
To the voice like that. I can hear it now. Merv Griffin. man with two brains.
Oh my God.
Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it.
Oh, wait a minute.
I know this.
Look at his face is red. Look at his
face. Oh, I know this.
This one hurts you, doesn't it? Because your face is so red right now.
That could be sunburn, too.
It could be. It was a very bright day outside.
Hit you up again?
Wait a minute. Is it back to school?
No.
Mm-mm.
It's not.
I can't no respect.
Oh, everybody at this table is looking a little stumped.
No,
okay.
That's...
Play it again.
All right.
I know this.
Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it.
Son of a bitch.
I'm out. I can't.
Billy Madison.
Oh!
And I thought it was funny because you all had mentioned it earlier, you know?
I know. I guess it's been a long time since I've seen it.
Interesting, I've never seen Billy Madison.
You're lucky.
I've never seen
really?
It.
Oh, really? You see it once.
It's one of the only good ones.
Really? See, Happy Gilmore was the best movie he's ever
made. Happy Gilmore was good. Billy Madison was almost as good. But that's why he calls it Happy Madison Productions. Because
it's the only two movies.
Oh, you didn't
two.
Like the,
I actually
like
Little
didn't
Nicky.
Like the recent one from Netflix? You didn't like...
You didn't like any of the cobbler, really?
You didn't like...
Cabla.
You didn't like his...
Glitch?
Yeah.
Was he in Glitch or Switch or something like that?
Whoopi Halloween.
Yeah.
Oh, Whoopi Halloween. Oh,
that one was kind of funny.
No, it wasn't.
All right, let's do a kids movie.
All right.
How about a kids movie?
Okay. I have kids, you know.
First, we should observe the ancient ritual of the, traditional pre-fight donut.
Yeah.
Rugrats?
No.
Pre-fight donut?
Oh, boy.
Backyardigans?
Backyardigans? What the fuck is backyardigans? Let me know if you need a hit up again. Still open round.
I'm not going to get this.
Yeah, I have no idea what this is.
Are you sure?
First, we should observe the ancient ritual of the, traditional pre-fight donut.
Yeah! SpongeBob?
No.
I've got
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
Can we have full title?
The Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
Secret of the
Ooze. Secret of the Ooze?
Bret called it.
Secret of the Booze.
Secret of the Booze.
Secret of the
Actually,
Booze.
Remember, the only reason I remember that movie is because Mad Magazine did a great parody of it with like a really awful caricature of Vanilla Ice, who of course was in that movie.
Vanilla Ice.
Yo, get that zero jet with the heat.
Go ninja, go ninja, go.
You know what's sad? Hold on.
What, Coolest Ice?
I know that rap from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, and I don't know how, but it's one of like,
ninja
those
rap.
Stupid parts. Yo, it's a green machine, gonna rock the town without being seen. Have you ever seen a turtle get down? Slamming and jamming to the new swing sound. Yeah, everybody let's move. Vanilla is here with the new jack groove. Gonna rock and roll the place with the power of the ninja turtle bass. Iceman, you know I'm not playing. Devastate the troll while the turtles are saying. Ninja, ninja, rap.
You see?
Wow.
That's Isn't that so horrible?
Sad. Yeah.
Isn't that horrible that I remember that?
This is why I liked Humpty Hump and I didn't like Vanilla Ice.
Well, you know what I got to say to that.
First, take a big step back and literally fuck your own face!
Tropic Thunder.
Tom Cruise.
I thought that was his best.
That was his best, role ever. The fact that he could be so calm and then just scream at
you. That actually wasn't acting.
He was talking to a Scientology
wasn't
people.
Wasn't he wearing fake hands? Like
Yes, he had fake hands, fake arm hair.
Yeah, wasn't it supposed to be like an entire bodysuit?
Yeah, he had a bodysuit and everything.
Because he had like big chest hair.
How about let's do a couple sci-fi movies and then and then we'll call it out. What
all
do you say? Sci-fi movie number one.
Don't wait for the translation! Answer me now!
Star Trek VI. The Undiscovered Country.
The Undiscovered Country. Wow.
Nice.
Very good.
Trekker. Wow.
Christopher Plummer. Yep.
Yep. You
Trekker
can, you,
right here.
Yep. Trek. Dude, I have a fucking Star Trek.
Oh, my God. He does.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Okay, never mind. For the people listening, there is an actual Star Trek tattoo where it should be, the badge.
It's right over the heart.
It's right over logical.
Where it belongs.
Only logical.
All right. Sci-fi still.
Dick, you're fired!
RoboCop. Yep.
Thank Andy called it first.
He did. He did.
Yep. Yep. Still doing some sci-fi?
Oh, no. You did not shoot that green shit at me.
Independence Day.
Yeah. Oh. Hey, man. Andy, I told you.
Nice.
He's doing good.
Hit me again.
Hit you again. Let me see if I can find one that is going to be tricky for you.
Ever notice how you come across somebody once in a while that you shouldn't have fucked with? That's me.
Oh, yeah.
That's Clint Eastwood.
I want to say it's Gran Torino.
That is the way. Oh, Wayne got it.
Clint Eastwood is super racist.
I thought that movie was a comedy. Okay, how could you not think it's a comedy when he's sitting at the table surrounded by these wonderful people that are feeding him food and he calls them a racial slur right to their faces? How did you not think that was a comedy?
It's like everybody's racist uncle.
Here's the thing about Clint Eastwood, though. In all of his movies, or almost all of his movies, but specifically the Dirty Harry movies, he always had that sense of progression of showing that he was always athletic. He was always in shape. He's always jogging. He's always running. He's always doing something. To get back to that Indiana Jones aspect, the time frame between the two movies of Last Crusade and Crystal Skull, we don't know how bad his body could possibly be up to this point. But when you see a Clint Eastwood movie, you're like, he's in his 80s and he's beating the crap out of a 20-year-old. And it's believable.
Yeah. And he's badass.
And he's badass, yeah.
All right, we're still doing another sci-fi one?
Do it.
Sure.
Let's see who can get stumped by this.
Baby, you make me wish I had three hands.
Total Recall.
Wow. Quick. Bing, bing, bing. Quick
bonus round.
I was about to say, we need to get like a buzzer or something.
I know. If only we could have like a buzzer.
If it's the woman with like three boobs, that would be like the boner round.
The boner round. Ooh. Want to switch gears to horror movies.
Go
love
for it.
Yeah, I think Wayne's going to kill on the next couple here.
Oh, yeah.
Let's do it.
We're friends to the end. Remember?
Wow.
Yep.
Couldn't even wait for the rest of it to play.
I'm sorry.
We're friends to the end.
You
remember?
You had it.
This is the end, friend.
Yeah.
Friend.
Excellent.
That's a classic.
The first one.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. See, like Friday the 13th, like Halloween, like all the other slasher movies, like the premise, the first one, beautiful. Everything else is just let's make money.
All right. This one. I don't really know if this is considered a horror movie, but sometimes when you go into like the mom and pop stores, they don't know how to classify it, so they put it in. It could be a comedy, it could be a horror. Okay.
It could be a porn. You never know.
Or it could be a porn. So we'll go with that category. So another one up for the grabs. Ready?
We killed it. Fuck you!
Tremors.
Yes.
Oh, nice.
Good job.
I couldn't get the first one, but as soon as I started hearing Kevin Bacon's voice, I'm like, that's Kevin Bacon.
And the moment he goes, fuck you.
Well, until the swear word, I was wondering, it's like, is that Night of the Living Dead, the original?
No.
Then I heard the fuck you, and it's like, okay, no, it's not.
Classic. Yes. Still doing horror movies.
Yeah.
Let's do one more.
Well, I bet you'd stick your head in fire if I told House you you could corpses. See hell.
Wow.
Meanwhile, you're too stupid to realize you got that a demon sticking out of your ass saying, holy Miss Moly, got me a live one.
Yeah, we've seen that a couple times. All right, so I think this should be the last one.
All right, okay. Last one.
Sure.
Again, action from the 90s that we grew up with.
Sounds good.
Oh, gosh, she's got the most incredible body and a pair of titties. Make you want to stand up and beg for buttermilk. Ass like a 10-year-old boy.
That sounded like Bill Paxton.
That is Bill Paxton.
That is Bill Paxton, but ass like a 10-year-old boy. What the hell? What movie would he say that in?
Sure, it wasn't the guy from Beetlejuice?
No,
they got Bill Paxton.
That's Bill Paxton.
They got it.
Well, that's not... Hold on. That's True Lies.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Nice.
That's right.
He was playing a douche.
He was playing the car salesman. Yes.
Car salesman.
Who was trying to be the secret spy so he can get with Jamie Lee Curtis's character. Yeah. Very good, guys.
Yeah. That makes sense.
All right. So everybody thinks, you know, we'll probably get to it in a little while, but everybody thinks Kingdom of the Crystal Skull might be the worst of the Indiana Jones trilogy.
Check your mic stand. You look like you're
falling. Okay, hold on. Well, I'll try that again.
There we go.
Okay, take two. A lot of people think that Crystal Skull might be the worst of the Indiana Jones movies, and you know, there might be something to that, but we'll get to that later. But people don't know there were also other scripts that were written, you know, in the interim between Last Crusade and Crystal Skull. One of them we have today was actually written by Chris Columbus from Goonies and young Sherlock Holmes fame, and it would make sense that he wrote an Indiana Jones script, since I don't know if any of you have seen young Sherlock Holmes. It does have the feel of a Victorian Indiana Jones. I mean, you have the whole Egyptology thing. You have sort of young Sherlock stepping in as a Indiana Jones surrogate. So, it doesn't. He's a great writer, and Goonies, I enjoyed Goonies at the time.
I read more of it once you sent the script to me. I read a bit more of it and tried getting into it. It lacked something.
So, as part of our little presentation, to those of you who still think Crystal Skull might be the worst in the films, we're going to present to you Indiana Jones and I think it was Indiana Jones and the Monkey King.
Indiana Jones and the Monkey King.
And so the part of Indiana Jones is going to be read by our own Andrew Shanley, who is at the moment developing his own Indiana Jones cosplay.
Fortune and glory.
And he'll actually be doing that at conventions hopefully sometime soon. Jamie, I would hope to take the part of McGowan.
Sure.
Wayne, I was actually going to have you... read a couple of the parts, so
sure.
If you could take, I'm just trying to find them right here. It's a few pages. So maybe you can write up. You could do the part of Priestley, which is later on. But there's also one other part in between that I kind of wanted you to.
Galdrath.
Priestley.
Galdrath. Yeah.
Wait, what was the name?
Galdrath. Oh, Galbraith.
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 Yeah, Galbraith.
So, you know, one of the people that are along with the Indiana Jones. And I'll read the part of Marcus, since he's one of my favorite characters. And also I'll read the part of the Baron Seagrove. All right, so starting at the beginning.
Take one.
Scotland, 1937. Suddenly, the man's fishing line becomes taut. The wooden pole buckles. The man stirs. He sits up. Moving the hat from his face, camera dollies fall forward into a close-up of the man. It's Indiana Jones, his face anxious, hopeful. Indy begins to reel in his catch. A voice interrupts in the distance.
Dr. Jones! Dr. Jones!
Indy turns in the direction of the sound, still struggling with the line. Indiana's point of view. Countless orange flames sparkle from the moors. The torches are being carried by several members of the small village. The villagers are gathered behind a group of six policemen. The policemen are headed by Inspector Angus McGowan, a plump, balding fellow with a veiny, bulbous nose, beady green eyes, and a thick, curled red mustache. McGowan shouts to Indy.
We need your assistance!
Come on, Mac. It's the first bite I've had all week.
Oh, please, it's very important.
Indiana struggles a bit longer with the line, but his conscience prevails, and Indy drops the fishing pole. With a grumble, he rows back to shore. The moors, several minutes later. Night has fallen. It is very dark. A reluctant Indiana has joined the inspector and the other policemen. They lead the townspeople across the foggy moors. Slowly, carefully, the villagers search, creeping, their faces tense. Many unable to hide the fear. A summer wind sends an eerie howl whistling through the night air. Blue moonlight bathes the moor, creating stark, frightening shadows. An expression of anger and annoyance covers Indiana's face. He grumbles to McGowan.
Do you value our friendship, Mac?
More than my nightly pint.
Well, this better not be some wild goose chase.
Tate wild geese whipped after, Dr. Jones. You got me word on that. And McGowan's word is truer than an angel's kiss.
Indiana gives a questioning look to McGowan. The inspector points to the castle's upstairs window.
That light only burns after a murder's been committed.
Let's go.
Indiana ascends the stairs, slowly, silently. Towards the light, McGowan and the others are directed behind Indy. As he makes his way to the top, Indiana examines the bizarre old paintings that line the wall. There are various portraits and landscapes, everything from military battles to Sunday picnics. But the unsettling quality of the pictures is that they each feature the same white-haired elderly man. Indy comments to Mac.
This guy's got one hell of an ego.
Baron Seamus Seagull of the Third. Some say he walks the moon every midnight. Other claims he's been dead for years.
McGowan looks at his men. The troubled look covers the inspector's face. McGowan's eyes dart about the room. Hennessy is gone.
Hennessy?
You're standing right here. Just a second ago, standing right beside me.
McGowan leans to his side, calling to Hennessy. McGowan's weight causes the rotten banisters to snap in two. He loses his footing. Falling off the side of the stairs, Indiana's arms shoot out, grabbing hold of McGowan's collar. Indy pulls McGowan back to safety. McGowan catches his breath, shaking.
Thanks for catching me.
I'd rather be catching trout.
They continue down the stairs, arriving at the bottom. It is a large, musty, stony basement. The slimy walls are covered with green moss. There are several doors among the basement walls. The sounds of the ringing bells are much louder down here. Indiana moves towards the first door. He reaches for the handle. The policemen draw their pistols. Indy opens the door. A large object shoots out from inside, rolling towards the men. The policemen fire their guns. Several shots ring out. The object comes to a stop. Deep red liquid pours onto the floor. Indy dips his fingers into the liquid. He tastes.
Interesting blood type.
The policemen stare wide-eyed. Indy smiles.
Cabernet Sauvignon, 1897.
Interior, banquet room. Baron Seagrove pours himself a glass of wine. A very angry Indiana walks towards the Baron.
Chow time's over, mister. You better start talking.
The Baron still ignores Indiana.
There's a lot of strange things happening around here.
A suit of armor located a few feet away from Indy suddenly twitches. Its arms lower, its head slowly turns.
Sounds like no Sherlock Holmes.
Indiana walks towards the Baron, who is only concerned with spreading butter on his bread. Indy shouts.
And I want some answers. Do you hear me? I want some answers. Now!
The Baron prepares to take another bite from his food. The sword shoots into the frame. The tip of the blade rests upon Baron Seagrove's rubbery throat. Indiana snarls.
Haven't you had enough?
Baron Seagrove finally looks at Indiana. The Baron lowers his fork. His face twists into an eerie grin. He begins to laugh. It's the same maniacal laugh we heard earlier. Indy responds by blowing out the flame of the mysterious candle. The room doors burst open. Inspector McGowan and Galloping dash inside. They hurry to Baron Seagrove, their pistols aimed at him. Galbraith handcuffs the Baron. McGowan looks at the bruised, bloodied, and tattered Indiana Jones.
Now you can get back to your fishing, Dr. Jones.
No chance, Mac. My plane leaves in the morning. Vacation's over. Gotta get back to school.
Ugh. 'Tis a shame to go back home empty-handed. Tell you what, my friend. I fancy myself quite a fisherman. Tomorrow, I'll go out and catch you a real beauty, eh?
Right. Send it to me airmail.
Dr. Jones, a McGowan's word is truer than...
Yeah, an angel's kiss, I know.
Exterior castle. The villagers surround the castle. Their bright torches are raised high in the air. Baron Seagrove is led out of the castle by Indiana and the police. The crowd begin to whisper, anxious, excited. As the Baron is led to the police vehicle, he turns and looks at Indy. The Baron speaks in a trembly, raspy voice. His eyes are wild.
No jail can hold me.
A chill rushes through Indiana. The Baron turns, continuing to the police wagon. One of the villagers shouts,
"He's done it! Indiana Jones has captured the killer!"
Cuts to Professor Thad Priestley enters, pushing Virgil aside. Priestley is a young, wisecracking, greasy-haired acquaintance of Indy. He shoves a photograph beneath Indy's nose.
Moby Dick.
Huh?
That's what her name and captain is said in The Biggest Fish Ever Saw.
Indiana glances at the photo. It is a picture of Professor Priestley dressed in a fisherman's outfit, standing on the pier holding a giant fish. Indy steams. Priestley gives him a manly slap on the back.
What about you, Jonesy? You over to Scotland for 2 weeks. Did you catch a big one?
Look, Priestley, I'm really busy.
Interior History Museum, prehistoric room. The large room is filled with skeletons, fossils, and statues dating back to the dawn of man. Indiana, his arms cluttered with the soaking term papers, hurriedly enters the museum with Marcus Brody. Marcus is very anxious, excited. He carries a 16mm metal film canister beneath his arms. Indiana is very impatient. His eyes dart to a full-sized skeleton of a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
This better be important, Marcus, or the museum will be soon displaying my bones. My teaching career is in danger of extinction.
You will not be disappointed, Indiana.
Cuts to, close-up, an ancient painting. The watercolor features an upright, wrinkled-faced Su Wong Kung, the Stone Monkey King. Nothing racist about that.
Look familiar?
Su Wong Kung, the Stone Monkey King. Big deal. That was 10 years ago, Marcus. Jesus, Heller's kid got the worst grammar.
10 years or 50 years. It'll always be in your blood.
Don't believe this. He spells repeat with two E's?
Think back, Indiana. Remember your desire, your passion.
Kid gets an A on content, a D on form.
Damn it, man. You can't bury those feelings forever.
2 years. Nearly 2 years of my life looking for the remains of that monkey. A piece of his legendary golden hooped rod or some sign of the lost city. 9 men perished on that journey. The rest of us nearly died from starvation or one of the many horrible diseases we discovered. We still came back empty-handed.
One mustn't give up so easy, Indiana.
Give up? Marcus, we spent 13 months in China, another 7 in India.
But not in Africa.
There's no proof, archaeological or anthropological, to indicate that Su Wong Kung ever visited Africa.
Until now.
That scared the hell out of me.
Damn it! Sorry about that. I couldn't figure out what Priestley should sound like.
That's
it said it was wisecracking, so I'm trying to think of like way to sound.
Hey, what's up, Jonesy?
Yeah, like a jerk.
Yeah, totally. Like, you know, channel in your like your Eddie from the, you know, Leave It to Beaver.
Oh,
Eddie Haskell.
Yeah. Oh, Eddie Haskell. Yeah.
Hey, Mr. Cleaver.
Hey, Mr. Jones. How you doing today? Which would make sense because that is the time frame.
Yeah. Before we get into Kingdom of Crystal Skull, should we talk a little bit about the TV show?
I think so,
you know,
yeah.
Young Indiana Jones Chronicles. Because I remember watching that show when it was on TV, and I enjoyed it for what it was.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't obviously a movie, but it was obviously television produced in the vein of an Indiana Jones movie.
Purely entertainment is what you enjoyed.
Exactly. Yeah.
Had two Doctor Who actors in a couple episodes. Colin Baker in one, and John Pertwee, who had played the third Doctor in another episode. I think they both played villains in that.
Yeah, and they had part of the show was him as a very young boy.
Yeah.
And then the other part of it was him as maybe like 18, 19, 20-year-old kid.
Somewhere around the age he was in Last Crusade.
Yeah. And of course they had another actor who played the older, much more older Jones.
And maybe in the latest film we'll find out, how did Indiana Jones lose his eye?
Yeah, I mean that was kind of interesting because they had an elderly guy. They would have it would open up the show with some contemporary form of people doing something.
Yeah,
and then like the old guy would be talking, like, you know, I remember back when we were fighting in the Great War, and he'd go right and segue right into
you little bastards.
You know,
wow. See, I barely remember anything about the show except that Sean Patrick Flannery starred in it.
Yeah.
Harrison Ford was actually in one of the episodes.
Was he?
Yeah, it was a one that was based in, it was like Chicago Jazz, and apparently Indiana Jones played
saxophone.
Yep.
Really?
And it was actually a great episode because it's like bearded Harrison Ford is Indiana Jones in like the 1950s,
That was a big deal.
Yeah. When they did it was that. A huge deal.
It was on ABC, right?
Yeah.
I believe
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You could probably watch some reruns of it.
Yeah. I think it was at that time that ABC had a deal with Disney and they were making programming. And Lucasfilm also, by way of that, was also still doing stuff because they were also making a deal with the theme parks. Because the Indiana Stone Show was in the theme parks.
Yeah. That's right.
And you had
so
like
Star Tours.
The Star Tours ride. So they were like, okay, well, we'll just kind of use that to segue into the whole situation. Now it's ironic because now Disney owns everything. So,
well, it's funny you mention that because there was the episode of The Muppet Show when Mark Hamill was in it. And they all end up singing When You Wish Upon a Star. Yeah. And, you know, like the magic Disney kingdom appears in the background. And you realize, holy mackerel. Disney owns The Muppets and Star Wars, and here they are, like, years and years. But then again, Jim Henson was a huge fan of Disney, and I think originally he wanted to sell The Muppets to Disney for that little bit of extra comfort in his what he'd probably hoped would be his later years. So, you know, The Muppets would be done by somebody else, and he'd probably keep on doing stuff with the Creature Shops.
Yeah, absolutely.
However,
yeah,
I barely remember anything about the Indiana Jones Chronicles.
The thing about it is I don't think they released a collection of that show on
Not
home
yet,
video.
No.
Really?
They did on VHS tapes. They had like when they were re-releasing the trilogy in VHS, they would include like one episode of the show.
Yeah.
And that was pretty much it. I mean, obviously, this was made in a day when if you had a VHS collection of an entire TV series, that could literally cover an entire bookshelf.
And it would probably cost you a lot of money.
Yeah, $30.
I mean, you look at
tape.
Like the complete collection of Dark Shadows.
Oh, my gosh.
Which, you know, has like millions of episodes because, it was produced on a daily basis. So you think like, you know, like a show like Young Indiana Jones Chronicles. Yeah. You know, most you know, VHS releases at that time, they, you know, do the best bits of the show or the best episodes
exactly.
from a show.
So, yeah, I mean, that was an interesting TV show.
Before we get into the Crystal Skull as well, and I mentioned Alan Quatermain earlier as, you know, because there was the King Solomon's Mines.
Oh, my, yes.
Things from the 1930s starring Cedric Hardwicke. However, I suppose, you know, Andrew and I in our love for canon films and what it was. Maybe we should mention the
glowing globus goodness.
Yes,
that is Alan Quatermain and the Lost City of Gold
and King Solomon's Mines.
Oh, yeah, I think that one of the interesting facets about that, if
Richard
you're familiar with,
okay, that's I was wondering who you were talking about, the Richard Chamberlain movies, guys.
Yes,
and it has Sharon Stone in it as well.
Yes,
that's
it
right.
If anybody knows anything about canon movies, knows Glolan Globus are a pair of cousins that were from
that's
Israel,
right.
and they ended up basically like fleecing Hollywood into thinking that they were the '80s kings of action movies, and they made a lot of action.
If anybody out there hasn't watched the documentary Electric Boogaloo, you got to check it out. It is really fascinating.
And it's a real insight into how they made their movies.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
So when, of course, the Indiana Jones thing started taking hold, they were really trying to make a buck off anything.
So why not get something that probably was in the public domain at that time, that was the character that inspired Indiana Jones.
Exactly.
And get an actor who, they should have just gotten Tom Selleck, but that's another story. That would have been interesting. But they instead went for Richard Chamberlain, who's a great actor, but I don't consider to be rugged action adventure quality to him.
Yeah,
that
was too smooth.
Of all the
scenes you see him in the desert, you expect to see cracks. You expect to see like signs of you're in an arid area for a long period of time.
Other,
it looks like he just came out of Ceylon.
And the other funny thing is, it also had John Rhys-Davies as the.
It did.
And what was this?
King Solomon's Mines. You could probably watch it for free on streaming.
See, yeah, I was thinking around that time that Indiana Jones was really popular, there was another company that tried to feed off of the popularity and created another character that was sort of
That's
rugged
what,
as
I
well.
I think we were talking about Alan Quatermain.
And we're talking about Jake Speed.
Oh, my God.
Oh,
yes.
Gosh.
Yes,
Jake Speed.
I remember that movie.
I felt bad because that was not a bad movie. It should have had a sequel.
It should have. But it was sort of like the
regale
the,
us.
The B movie version of of Indiana Jones.
And there was also another great film called Romancing the Stone.
Yes.
Which was a good film.
But that wasn't a B movie. That that was well done.
Yeah, that was very well done. And
but it was in that vein.
In that same type of know, rugged character, the guy and the damsel in distress. Yeah. So
the treasure to be found.
And the treasure.
The bad guys.
And there's also that moral dilemma. Do I save the girl? Do I take the gold? It's always that moral dilemma that the hero or anti-hero has to come up with.
Absolutely.
Right. And it had Danny DeVito in it.
Oh, Danny DeVito was hilarious in those movies.
He's great in everything.
They made two of those. But like the quarter, like, you know, like Glowing Globus.
I'm going to get you, Colton. a penguin is a bird that can't fly.
You do that too well.
It's me or nobody, Rhea.
You have also, like, you know, when they remade The Mummy.
The 2017.
I'm talking about, like, you
Tom Cruise?
No, not that.
You're talking about
Brendan Fraser.
Okay.
I mean, there was a lot of the Indiana Jones kind of mentality in those that character as well. You know,
they were goofy fun.
That was goofy fun. It was a lot like Raiders.
But that is an example of how CGI started to kill the movie.
And I agree with you there as
because
well.
Because it took away any work that an actual decent special effects man can do and said, we'll just let the computer take care of it.
Exactly.
And it's like, no, dude, I mean, it just... It's not the real. It's not the same thing.
Exactly. I think CGI can be a great tool, but it shouldn't be the be all to end all. It shouldn't be.
Which is what it's becoming.
Exactly.
Yep. Yep.
I miss the.
Well, here's the thing about why they're doing more and more CGI is
it's cheaper.
It's much easier to say. Well, look at a movie like Indiana Jones, where they didn't have any type of computers to do any of the effects.
Everything was
so if you had a character that was falling off the cliff, well, the way that character or Temple of Doom, actually, I'll use that as a better example. The bridge scene where all of the bad guys are falling off of the they're falling off of the bridge.
Well,
you see them
to see Kali in hell.
So what they did.
That's like a wrestling match.
What they did is they actually animated they hand animated characters that looked like the priests people, and they hand animated them behind a blue screen falling down, and that's how they got some of those crazy special effects.
I started chuckling,
and it took so much time in Star Wars doing the hand animation for for the Tauntaun.
Well,
that took so much time.
Well, think about when they did the Emperor.
But it mattered.
Empire.
Yeah, it did matter.
It mattered. That time that they took really mattered. Instead of, doing the complicated CGI things and, like, clicking a shader and putting this thing over. I mean, that's – you're missing the whole point of the real feel behind the special effect.
You just made me think of when they did the – introduced the Emperor in Empire Strikes Back, which was, I think, part of – I think it was either one of the designers of the makeup or the makeup lady's wife's face, monkey eyes, and they put that together.
The original one was Clive Revell.
Well, no, that was his voice. Took the woman's. They actually had his wife's mouth doing the.
I didn't know that.
Yep, if you see the original hologram of the Emperor when he first appears and he's talking to Vader, he looks completely different from the Emperor that we see later on.
Because it was a composite. It was of two different.
Exactly, because he had like the eyes were weird and bulging.
They were
bulging in a way. Yeah. So. Yeah, weird.
But
Mandela
it just gave
effect.
This really, it just gave this real unsettling feel to it. But I thought it worked so
yes.
well.
Yes, it was unsettling.
Yes,
But you know, again, it goes right back to what was special.
Yep.
About special effects.
Special effects. They
were
special.
It was crafted. By
and actually, when you were mentioning the falling scene, all I could think of was like from Last Crusade when suddenly the tank falls right at the camera with the Nazi in it.
That screaming as it's going down.
I mean, it looked so bad, but at the same time, you enjoyed it because it was just so goofy.
Well, and because you know that was a real thing that fell, and instead of like some computer that
had to
calculate
the scene right
how many
Harrison
polygons
hat,
it takes, you know, and
hat flies off his head, you know, that whole scene where it just all just sort of happens that way.
But yeah, so I think that like you know when we see like the when Kingdom of the Crystal Skull was produced, there was a long time between, you know, the last time
yep.
Harrison was Indy, and then when he became Indy again.
I think I did like the fact that, you know, I will give the film credit that they sort of pushed time ahead where it was the 1950s, where it's like, the you know, the time has passed. The character has aged. They're not trying to say it's like 1940s Indiana Jones.
Yeah, right. I know. There's no way they could because Harrison Ford, like, he was like in his 70s.
Yeah.
However, there are certain scenes in the movie where he does a lot of running, and you're just I'm sorry. I know 70-year-olds. They ain't doing that.
And when you see Indiana now running, and you're like, oh, I can see him favoring his hip. You know?
Well, I mean, especially, like, you know, like, the action sequences, and I know I've mentioned the action sequences in the other movies. There was some real tangible, like, things going on in all these action sequences beforehand, whereas when you went to the action sequences in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, it seemed like there were more set pieces to highlight certain things, like the rocket sled.
Or the sword fight.
And the sword fight.
Oh, I thought that was so ridiculous. That was unnecessary.
The refrigerator.
And the
monkeys.
And the ants.
The refrigerator.
The ants I thought were super cool. They were huge.
But no, the monkeys?
What?
Hey, we're the monkeys. Yeah. People say we're monkey.
Well, even
around.
Just the ending with the alien face coming at you, just looking like really weird. It's like, are they trying to do the angel of death from Raiders? Only it's like an alien face, and it just mm-hmm. doesn't work as well.
I actually showed this interview to both of you. It was a DVD extra on the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull that somebody put on YouTube. And
yes,
it shows Spielberg and Lucas in separate interviews talking to each other. And Spielberg starts it out by saying, when I finished Last Crusade, I was pretty much finished. I was done. I didn't want to do any more of these
That
movies.
Was why I filmed Indiana Jones going off into the sunset.
I know.
Because he was done.
And George, he's like, hey, we got to do another one. And he's like, George, come on. We can't do any more. Okay, well, what are we going to do? We're going to do one with aliens. And so they were like, oh, he's like, all right, fine. But, you know, he's like, literally, this is exactly his attitude.
I get the mentality where it's like you went with, you know, biblical mythology in the first one. You went with, you know, like with the Temple of Doom. You went with that sort of motif with the second one. And then you went with the Arthurian legend with the third one. Mm-hmm. So now it's like sort of... doing 50s sci-fi.
Yeah, 50s sort of, sci-fi.
Yeah.
Oh, because they wanted to do it for the times.
I mean,
of the times,
one of the
it
original
was...
titles was Indiana Jones and the Saucer Men.
And the Saucer Men.
Earth versus soup.
And so.
World War Space.
And so when Independence Day came out, you know, all of a sudden, like, Spielberg was like, George, they just did an amazing... in an alien invasion movie. They did an awesome job at it. It's as good as I would probably ever do. We can't do this.
We're
now.
Boned.
We're screwed. We can't do this. Oh, well, they're not aliens anymore. They're interdimensional beings.
Interdimensional.
And that was kind of...
They're interdimensional.
They're, you know, they're all interdimensional beings now. You know.
I'm going to go play with my Ewoks.
I'm going to play with my action figures now. You know.
No, sir, we didn't see you playing with your dolls again.
Be sure you don't.
I'll have you killed.
But he probably could. But that was the thing. Like, you know, it was clear, like, you know, it was kind of like he turned, and I call it the Dan Aykroyd.
With Ghostbusters, right?
With Ghostbusters, where Dan Aykroyd was like, we got to do another one.
I think because they were so unhappy with Ghostbusters 2, they figured, we got to do Ghostbusters 3 to sort of do the movie we want to do. And it's like, and then finally it's like, oh, we're going to do a sequel, but we're not going to use any of your ideas. Sorry.
Exactly. But when they did Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, they're like, okay, well, it was like, you look at them on the set, and it looks like there's two guys hanging out and just having a good time. That's the reason why they made it.
Yeah. Well, that's the reason why most actors choose whatever movie they're doing.
I mean,
where's this filming?
I mean,
Hawaii?
Yeah. I was glad they brought Karen Allen back.
That was cool.
Yeah, that was nice.
Like, when they did the interview, and she, you know, it's like when it was like pre-production of the movie, and with the cast, like Harrison Ford, Spielberg, maybe Lucas was there, I can't remember. And you go, and we got somebody else, and she comes on the set. It's like, oh, they brought Marion back, finally.
Yeah.
He's been waiting
like we had to.
20, 30 years for that role.
But of course, then you have Shia LaBeouf. Actual no cannibal Shia LaBeouf.
The character wasn't bad.
No, he wasn't.
The character wasn't bad. They just chose the wrong actor.
Well said. Well said.
I don't know. I mean, he himself is a great actor. If you guys ever seen the movie Fury.
Yes, that's a good example.
That's a good movie he did.
He's a great character actor, but he's not going to be anything good for like for an Indiana Jones. Like, or as they thought that they were going to like pass.
You're walking through the woods.
They were going to pass Indiana Jones off to like another person to be like, now this person's going to carry the hat and be Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
Shia LaBeouf would not be the person to do that.
Well, they tried to make him like really badass where he's like, his first scene he comes out, they try to make him look like Marlon Brando from The Wild Ones. Like, dressed in leather.
His name is Mutt.
Mutt.
Well, there's this new movie he's in. What the hell is it called? Some action. Tax Collector.
Tax Collector.
Yep. That's it. Yeah. He was badass in that movie. I mean, he can really act, but I don't see him as being this Indiana Jones character.
Yeah, I think that some actors can do it and some actors can't. Again, I think that part of it was obviously just...
It was popular casting of the time.
It was popular casting of the time. Right. And that's, they get the hot actor or
hey,
whatever.
This guy's doing this Transformer movies. Maybe we should put him in ours.
Throw him in the movie.
That's not how you
do it. And not to crap all over the movie and George Lucas, but at the same time, I can understand why he picked the 1950s as that, because that was the era he grew up in. You know, my dad grew up late 1950s, you know. Hot rods and all that. So I think, you know, making one indie film that was in the era he remembers, you know, like the cars of that era, motorcycles.
Yeah, that's why it opened up with the cars racing,
yep,
you know, racing
exactly.
Through
I
those
mean,
hot rods.
American Graffiti was a great film.
I was actually on one of the sets they actually shot that scene at.
Oh, really?
When I was there, I wasn't actually in the production, but they actually, me and a bunch of other people, we went down to Hartford, Connecticut.
Oh, wow.
And we actually went to the streets and everything else like that. It was quite an experience. Because
I didn't realize they filmed down in Hartford.
Yeah. Well, or what was it? It was in Connecticut. It was right near the...
The university.
Yeah.
The university scenes. Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. So they got all those scenes, and they literally they had classic cars all up and down the streets.
That was my dad's era.
They literally took like water and just kind of dusted all the cars.
That's probably your dad's era too, Jamie.
Yep. So they looked like they were worn. They had Teamsters that would wear period clothes from the waist up, and on the bottom they had jeans and sneakers, and they had like, pink tape around them saying driver, and there was all these guys just dressed in period clothing. We saw the camera car. They replaced all the signs. They actually took all the
signs.
Yeah, all the modern signs down. Put old signs up. They took.
Yeah, there were no stop signs in the 50s.
No, right? Like street signs and
street
building signs.
What are you talking about? For the longest time, there were no stop signs at Kelly Square.
There still aren't anywhere.
Thank you.
The meters, the parking meters, they replaced. Yep. They put like shrubberies in front of all the poles. It was quite impressive. And like, so, you know, just being there and kind of like engrossing it and everything else like that was quite an experience.
Yeah.
And I honestly think, especially for that movie, that scene with them, you know, with the motorcycle chase scene, is probably the best action scene in the whole film, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
Which is sad, because it's in the beginning of the movie.
Right.
Exactly. So it's like, oh, great, I got nothing else to look forward to.
Exactly. I mean, there were other things that were kind of cool, and I think that were interesting. But
I kind of like the opening warehouse scene.
That was pretty good, too.
That was kind of fun.
I brought up the refrigerator earlier.
Yeah.
That was actually
something.
I know.
Everybody
it's like,
hates
that's what
the refrigerator.
I know.
Spielberg.
I feel like it was one of those scenes that they ended up like on MythBusters. I think they tried to prove or disprove.
The thing about it is Spielberg actually owned up on that and said, no, that wasn't George's idea. That was mine.
Well, at least he did.
At least he owned that.
Exactly.
But yeah. So I mean, the rest of it was CGI. It was just felt really kind of disconnected.
Yeah.
From everything, because it really feels like a completely different film.
Right.
And, you know, filmmakers change over time. You know, Spielberg changes his style a little bit over time. I mean, he had just after he did Indiana Jones in the Last Crusade, he's doing movies like, you know, like Schindler's List.
That's right. Yeah.
He's doing movies like, Munich. You know, he's
took over, what's his name, Kubrick's last film, didn't he?
Yeah, he did
Eyes Wide Shut.
He did that.
Yeah. AI was not Kubrick's.
No. AI was...
Eyes Wide Shut is Kubrick's.
Eyes Wide Shut was Kubrick's, but he was planning on doing...
I'm sure it was AI or A1, the steak sauce movie.
Kind of feels either way. But that was the thing. It was like he turned into a completely... He was doing the War Horse.
Yep.
I don't think he did.
Wasn't he responsible for Band of Brothers, the HBO series?
He was a producer on it.
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, because of Saving Private Ryan.
Saving Private Ryan. That meant thinking of mm-hmm. more historical pieces. More
and he's also
more
back
realistic.
In the day. He also did his dramatic stuff with Empire of the Sun.
Oh yeah.
Yes, he did.
You know,
but more so in the 90s. I think that really is the period where he really said, I'm going to become a serious filmmaker.
Artist.
Right.
Yeah. I'm going to be an artist now.
Real artist.
I'm going to win an Oscar, which he finally did.
Yeah.
You know, the Academy was never going to give, like, Indiana Jones a
Jurassic Park.
Jurassic Park was another. Oh, that's a beautiful film.
Yeah.
But, so, like, you know.
His vision is based on movement. You bred raptors. You bred raptors.
You can't lock a raptor in the closet. They're too smart. They'll get out.
The critic. Yes.
I mean, and he bangs the door. And doesn't he come in with like a pipe or something?
I beg to differ. You see, the other grafters and I have constructed a crude bridge to Venezuela. Once they are lie low and take our jobs under the name Mr. Pilkington. But perhaps I've said too much.
But yeah, so he really, you know, it was just a kind of, he had to kind of come back. I think that once he had gone into the artistic filmmaking, the art, you know, the Oscar style filmmaking of making these movies, going back to suddenly, you know, oh, I'm going to make a fun movie now. That's
it's kind of like Keanu Reeves coming back to do Bill and Ted. It felt really kind of stilted.
I mean, I liked the Bill and Ted movie.
I did too, but it's
but it did feel a little hollow.
This is after Matrix.
I mean,
this is after John Wick.
Alex Winter came back. He did great.
I thought he was good.
Absolutely.
Alex Winter has always been great. He still did. I mean,
he did a great Frank Zappa documentary.
Yeah.
Yeah. That Freaked was a great film.
Freaked was awesome.
And actually, the funny thing is, both him and Keanu Reeves are in that movie too, as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That's actually a really unsung gem.
93, 95.
Yeah, I think that's one of his last acting roles. One of his last big acting roles was
screen
that.
Role. Yeah,
yeah. Because then after that, he became a director.
The other thing about Kingdom of Crystal Skulls is almost got Sean Connery out of retirement.
Oh,
because after League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, he was just like, you know, fuck it, I'm done.
Yeah.
And
it didn't help the reviews that movie got, which is unjustified because I liked League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
I didn't mind it until I read the original comic book series, and the original comic book series is just so much better than the movie. But I mean, it was one of these things. It was one of these things. The writer Alan Moore hated the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen because he had written the original comic, but he also really disliked a lot of the treatment of a lot of what Hollywood did to his work. He couldn't stand From Hell, which if you read the original graphic novel, it's more historical. It doesn't have this whole mystical bullshit that they did in the movie with Johnny Depp's character being psychic. There was an actual psychic
psychic connection.
There was an actual psychic in the original Jack the Ripper case.
It wasn't opium. It was absinthe.
Absinthe.
Oh, yeah. Didn't they find him in an opium?
Yeah, he wasn't. The original detective wasn't an opium fiend. There was a psychic, but it was two different people. Robert Lees was the psychic. Aberline was the detective, and Robert Lees was actually a fraud, at least according to the original From Hell. And the other project he did was Watchmen, which, you know.
Yeah.
The original, again, actually, that was one of those few films where the movie pretty much almost matched the original series, but still.
It was still lacking.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think, honestly, Watchmen, if I can talk on Zack Snyder a little bit, is probably one of his best movies he's done.
It's true, yeah.
He's good when he has material that's written by other people, but like when he starts making material himself, it doesn't exactly work.
I was just waiting for them to put Hallelujah in Justice League, because he seems to put Hallelujah in everything he does.
That music.
And you always have to play Hallelujah when you're banging someone.
That's the thing.
Rough
that song.
Sex, Hallelujah.
Rough
Hallelujah
sex.
Was that one song that would, every time I would hear it, it would always invoke a response in me that I would make me feel like really sad. Really, yeah. Really.
What? Stop it.
You're hitting the microphone.
Am I? Oh, sorry.
Every time you move, you hit a cable.
Sorry. Anyway, when I heard that song on The Watchmen, it just completely killed it.
Yeah.
Now every time I hear that song, yeah, all I can think of is two people banging at it, going at it.
Yeah.
In a friggin' floating ship.
In a floating owl.
Oy. Hallelujah. That killed it. It killed it.
Hey, who doesn't want to do it that way?
Hallelujah.
Well, now there's actually talk about the other Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
Now, yeah, what have you read about this new Indiana Jones, Bret?
Oh, gosh.
Because you've done more research than I've...
I've done a little bit. I've just seen these articles that have come up. Some of it, I don't know if you can just take it as a grain of salt, but they're talking about Indiana Jones and space Nazis.
Yeah.
Well, it's like, I don't know if it's supposed to take place in the late 50s or the late 60s. It's supposed to take place during the space race, and apparently he's going to be fighting Nazis. One of the reports
Nazis on the moon.
Nazis in space.
Have you ever seen the movie Iron Sky?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Fantastic B+
it's,
movie.
That's a fun movie to watch. C+.
Right now you can watch it for free on Tubi.
Yeah. It's a fun movie to watch.
Please. Not a sponsor.
Please sponsor?
No. And they made a couple more, I believe. They made like two or three sequels.
Yep.
Which I think is...
It all started off as a crowdfunded movie.
Yeah, it was all Kickstarter. All Kickstarter. And basically,
it's amazing how many things by Kickstarter are funded nowadays.
Well, yeah, I think you take a
Veronica
look at especially...
Mars came back because of the
Mystery
fans.
Science Theater 3000.
Mm-hmm. MST3K came back because of
Veronica
the
Mars.
Which I think needs to be a whole thing of another podcast talking about MST3K, but another day.
I mean, honestly, I think that the nature of how movies are made and how movies are marketed today is changed quite a bit, especially considering just how the funding is coming from.
Yeah.
The world has changed. I mean, it's like I've had so many friends who have, funded books or funded projects, just because of Kickstarter.
Yep.
And it's just amazing the things that can, going back to like even the Mystery Science Theater 3000 funding their own series without a television network now. Through Kickstarter, they funded the whole thing in a day.
Yeah.
In a day.
Yeah. Yeah,
just by making a simple announcement on Twitter can change the entire flow.
It's
of
the way
project.
It's like
there was a guy.
Social media can be a great thing, for promotion. It can also be a complete ass.
Have you ever heard the story about the guy who went on Kickstarter and said, "I'm going to make mashed potatoes"?
Yes, I did hear about this.
No, I did not.
Okay, so this guy said, "I'm going to make some mashed potatoes." And I'm looking for people to support me to make mashed potatoes. And people sent him money to make mashed potatoes. And not just, a little bit of money. Like, he collected, like, a couple $100,000. I mean, and he's like, okay, well, maybe I'll make some, I might make some more mashed potatoes. I might say thank you to the people who might ask me to make mashed potatoes. It's truly...
And
an amazing
make some cheesy
story.
Mashed potatoes.
It's just bizarre.
There's options,
some bacon
man.
In there,
There's options.
Go au gratin on my mashed potatoes.
No, you'll go au gratin, all right.
Well, I don't know if Indiana Jones should be fighting Nazis
I don't know.
In space.
I'm wondering
or
if
on
it's
the
just,
moon.
It's reaching. It's stretching. Yeah,
well, see, that's the thing that got me about Crystal Skull. I mean, everyone's like putting it down because the alien aspect was what the storyline was.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, you don't have a problem with the idea of God creating an ark that can send a laser that can destroy people, but you're okay, or you're not okay with aliens? It's like, I did not see the aliens as being a problem in the progression of the storyline.
I think it's the storyline.
Here's my attitude towards all that. When I take a look at it like this, and I think this is a very good way to look at it, especially like not just Indiana Jones, but any major franchise of the last 30 years, I think that every franchise has kind of like what I call a use-by date or a sell-by date. You know how you go to the grocery store and you get the milk and you look at the milk and you see how long it's going to last
for. It's a freshness warning.
It's a freshness warning.
Then there's those people that buy like five or six jugs of milk and you're like, yeah, enjoy them when they all expire at the same time.
You have to like literally drink all the milk at once.
If you weren't lactose then, you will be now.
And I think that especially today when you take a look at, Star Wars or you take a look at Star Trek, or you take a look at Indiana Jones, or these properties, they're no longer properties that are owned or controlled by the original people who created them. You know?
Yeah.
Gene Roddenberry is dead.
Yep.
Lucas doesn't own any of his properties anymore.
No.
Spielberg, they would probably bring him back to direct. I don't
know. No, actually, he stepped down.
Yeah, I would imagine.
I think it's maybe an executive. I don't know.
He's probably going to produce it. He won't direct it.
Just executive producing, yeah.
And Harrison Ford, I mean, you know, he's already been on the fence.
He's on the
back
door of 80 now.
He's been even through his career.
Or the front door of 80, sorry.
He's always been Harrison. Like, I don't know if I want to reprise Han Solo. I don't know if I want to reprise Indiana Jones.
What the fuck are you talking about?
Well, I think it's funny on that. How Harrison Ford took the movie The Force Awakens with the understanding that he would get shot in it.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah.
And it's the same idea as Charlton Heston from Planet of the Apes.
Yeah.
When he made the Planet of the Apes, Charlton Heston's not a sequel guy. He does not make sequels. He said that himself. Yeah. I don't make sequels.
I like my vagina.
when they offered him Beneath Planet of the Apes, he was like, no. And they're like, well, we'll offer you all this money. He was like, no. I was like, you got to make it. It's like, no. Okay, I tell you what. I'll make it if I get killed off in the story, and then I don't have to come back and do it again. That was the only reason why he took that movie.
That's right.
But you better not replace me with Roddy McDowell. Oh, shit. You replaced me with Roddy McDowell.
Son of a bitch.
Oh, my God. Guys, this is up to almost 45 minutes.
Wow.
Damn. On top of the other ones we just did. We've been we have over an hour and a half of recording.
That's good.
Yeah.
I think we got some stuff for Bret to edit.
I don't mind. I love putting these things together.
But going back to what I was saying, I think that, you know, nothing's going to change the fact that Raiders is a great film.
No, true. Absolutely.
Nothing's
going to
change
right.
the fact that that Temple of Doom is a great film Last Crusade is a great film.
True.
But obviously you can see as time goes by the delusion of the quality of the product.
Diluting.
The diluting of it and seeing that it just kind of it isn't the same as it was before.
Well, you were mentioning earlier about, you know, them riding off into the sunset.
Exactly.
And that was the feeling of Last Crusade was they, you know, you had this nice little bookend and they were all riding off into the sunset and that was, you know.
Yeah.
It was a nice note to end if that was to be the end of the series, it was a nice note to go out
it's
on.
Like you take
been.
A look
it
at like
been, absolutely.
Yeah, it's like you take a look at been. The people that look at the Star Wars trilogy, like Return of the Jedi is the end.
Yeah.
You know, they don't like any of the movies, but they original trilogy the way it
well,
was
what
set
I
up.
Think is going to be funny is it's like
the
I remember
Holy
when
trilogy.
I remember when Disney bought Star Wars and everybody was like, oh great, finally they're getting, you know, taking Star Wars away from Lucas, thinking back to the prequels and saying it's finally Star Wars is going to be great, and then three movies later it's like, oh, we got to bring back Lucas. He these movies have been ruined.
Well, here's the thing about Lucas. Lucas is an amazing storyteller.
Yeah, he is.
He is unbelievable. He comes up with these concepts, these ideas. He's not
He's not great at executing.
Yes. I mean, he's a good director, but there are
no,
better.
No, he's not.
No, I feel he's a good director.
Can
I just
you
think
go
there's
faster?
Better.
Can you go slower? Can you go faster?
I think
can you
that
go slower?
If you've ever
better director
seen...
than Schumacher.
How many people here have ever seen the review of the prequels by Red Letter Media? You have, obviously.
I think I probably... They're great.
In his directing style, when he first started out with Star Wars... He had to fight to get that movie done.
Right,
he had
sure.
to compromise. He had to work with a whole ton of people to get people like his wife at the time was editing.
Yeah, and she did a brilliant
and
job
she,
editing.
That was a movie that was saved by editing if it wasn't for her and the other people. And as he grew into the George Lucas that we know today, he became we all know that. But he doesn't have anybody telling him,
sorry.
He turned into
you
the
bumped
person.
A cable, dude.
I know.
He turned into
don't
the
don't bump cable. He'll shoot you.
I'll shoot first.
He turned
so
into
dark.
The
you're
the
from
George
the DC
Lucas
universe
that nobody says no to.
Right, yeah, and
good point.
It's funny. I don't know if anyone's here has seen the movie Bohemian Rhapsody, the biopic on Queen.
Yes,
there's a scene in the movie when he comes back. I forget the guy who plays Freddie Mercury.
Oh, I know.
Rami Malek.
Rami Malek, thank you. He goes off, he does a solo thing, and then he comes back, and the four of them are in this little office room, and they're talking. And he said that pretty much the same thing you just said. He said, when I told the guys to play this, they played it. When I told them to change this, they changed it. I didn't have any arguing coming from you. I didn't have any pushback coming from the drummer. I didn't have any grief coming from the bassist, which made me rethink my idea to shape it into something much better. Mm-hmm. When you have total autonomy, unless you know exactly what you want to put out and have it to be a brilliant piece, if you are just going to be surrounded by yes men, you're going to get crap.
And that's exactly what we have here. We had in the prequels is that nobody said no to him.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, Jar Jar Binks was not a bad character. The concept was bad. The yes. idea of how he was made was bad. But to introduce the character as a middleman between the Naboo and the... Man, I forgot the underwater people.
The Gungan.
Gungans, thank
don't
you.
Don't ask how I remember.
No, again, it's like one of those little things that just goes right in my head. Yeah. But the Naboo and the Gungan using him as a middleman... Great idea. Making him the way you made him?
Yep.
Totally After Padme stupid. After died, Naboo changed his name to Naboo Who.
That's funny.
But yeah, I think that was...
Thank you, Kevin Murphy.
But that was kind of the thing. He never had anybody that challenged his ideas or gave him that, George, I think you need to rethink this.
Well, I heard stories from a friend that, you know, when they were doing like Lucas video games back in the 90s, he would have these ideas going into, you know, he would bring up these character ideas in meetings saying, I want to come up with a character and his name's going to be Darth Icky. And everybody would be sitting around the table saying, is he serious? Is he actually, is this a real character? Is he being serious? I think he's being serious. Oh, shit.
But yeah, I mean that was the thing about Lucas, and listen, I will always say, the man innovated filmmaking.
Oh, absolutely.
But he became, it's kind of like that line that Harvey Dent throws in The Dark Knight, you know.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
You know, the one where he's like, you know,
you either live long, you're either the hero, or you live long enough to be the villain. Was it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, he started out as an independent filmmaker with movies like THX 1138. With movies like, you know,
American Graffiti.
American Graffiti. And when he was doing Star Wars, he wanted to do, you know, Flash Gordon instead.
That's right.
And then, you know, when he finally got Star Wars done, he had to fight so hard. The studio was like, we don't want any part of this. We'll distribute it. It's not going to make any money. Nobody's going to want this thing. Blah, blah, blah.
Well, there was the story of Mark Hamill and Carrie Fisher being at the back of a theater when they were doing, like, the commercials for Star Wars, and it's like, you know, coming to your galaxy this summer, and somebody's like, and coming to late night TV later in the year,
because that was the thing. All those actors who were in the metal scene at the end of the movie, they're all like, you know, they're all making fun
they're
of
snickering
the
and
cast.
Laughing, yeah, as they were walking by,
yeah, like wanker, are you fucking jokes?
That was the thing. Actually, Alec Guinness was somebody.
What the fuck are we doing here?
Alec Guinness was somebody who didn't enjoy the dialogue. He didn't enjoy working on it, but
he hated his role as Obi-Wan Kenobi.
But he stood up for George Lucas, and he was one of the people who actually, despite his, you know, I don't want to do this. I thought the dialogue was a bit ropey, but I thought there was good bones there.
And now,
but he stood up for George Lucas.
Single one of those guys is literally going to comic conventions. Like, hey, my hand was on this starship for like 5 seconds, and they're signing autographs. There's actually a documentary about those guys.
Actually, that's something we should bring up. A fan, you know, the fan documentary on Indiana Jones.
Oh boy.
About, you know, the kids who actually decided making an Indiana Jones.
Yep. I think that
scene by scene,
shot for shot,
and these
VHS
were like, what,
handheld cameras.
What were they like?
So they had to edit on
the
fly.
Time.
I mean,
they were obviously,
you know,
best
this
friends.
This would have been us, you know, as kids.
It would have been what we were doing with our friend Artie running around Spencer with our cameras
exactly.
and fake guns, and because every movie that we made was some sort of drug deal gone wrong. Yeah. Even
and
though.
Here were these kids.
So which one was Crockett and which one was Tubbs?
Oh, there was none of those characters.
No one to root for.
It was literally like some dude would just go into a back alley and be like, I'm buying drugs. Okay, and then some guy would show up with a gun and they would kill him. There. There's very little plot development characters. And here are these
kids from, I forget where the kids were located out of, but, they loved Raiders of the Lost Ark, and they wanted to do a play by, a scene by scene recreation of the film. And, I don't know if anybody, if you guys have all seen the documentary, and it's just really amazing.
I've seen parts of it, and, honestly, it's just one of those things that, it indicates just, that's the thing. It really kind of inspired a lot of filmmakers.
Yeah.
I mean, actually, the funny thing is you can go on YouTube and see dozens of fan films based on Indiana Jones. And they're not all American. They're all like Spanish,
the scene
Spanish,
that got me
German.
Was they actually the fire in Marion's bar?
Yep.
They actually tried to recreate that in their parents' basement.
With real fire.
A real fire. They almost caught their parents' basement on fire.
Yeah.
And you're just like,
because they did it. They did it on their parents'
bar. I'm
just
bar. Like, holy mackerel! If we did that down in my parents' basement, and my dad came home, I wouldn't be sitting right here right now because he would have probably broken my neck, buried me in the backyard, and you would have never heard from me again. Or if you were part of it, probably you too.
Yep, I'd be there.
Hey,
we'd both be dead.
Anything happens to her, I got a .45 and a shovel. I promise you will not be missed.
No one will miss you.
Yes. The thing about it was they also did a Kickstarter, and they reshot. There was one scene that they didn't shoot.
The airplane scene.
The airplane fight scene, which they actually got somebody to build the plane for them and all that stuff, and they actually recreated it. I think like 20 years later. Just now they're all like 40 years old or something like that.
Yeah.
But also an interesting concept or look at that of the young filmmakers, the kids and everyone who's doing all that stuff.
Yeah.
Kind of like George Lucas back in the day, but
right.
It really more reminds me of people like Roger Corman.
Yes.
I love Roger Corman.
Yeah, Roger Corman, another guy, unbelievable work that he would do in the time.
He would do these B movies, but then he did an about face and did these great adaptations of Edgar Allan Poe with Vincent Price, and they were just brilliant films.
Mm-hmm. I mean, people like James Cameron. Thank you.
James Cameron got
his start through Roger Corman.
I thought you were thinking like
James Newton James Howard Cooper. Got his start from James Roger Corman, and Roger Corman was one of those people who would be like. You would go up to him and say, listen, Raj, I understand you want me to make this movie, but I need a little bit more budget, or I need some more special, but I need this, that, or the other thing. And Roger would look at them, put his hand on their shoulder, and go, no. Do it with what you got.
Because that's the way he did it.
Yep. That's the way he did it, exactly.
And that's the way movies used to be made. But now look at some kid and go, hey, can you push a space bar for me?
Cool. There was a great video by somebody by Film Theory, I believe it is, on YouTube, and they had interviewed a guy about why a lot of movies today aren't good. And he said, well, back in the day when you made like movies like, Star Wars.
Back in my day.
You had one box to check. Fun. And that was it.
Yeah.
It was a fun movie. People enjoyed it. Now, you take a look at movies today, they have like multiple boxes on top of multiple boxes. They're trying
subcategories.
Subcategories. Yeah. We're gonna make them. We gotta do this. We gotta do that. We gotta do this. We gotta check this box. Check that box. We don't have that box. Okay, we gotta spend $80 million in reshoots to get that one checkbox.
It's funny you mention that because I remember Peter Sellers talked about that with George Formby making films because he says at the time he says films nowadays is like, well, I really don't think that it really matches the upper echelon of that. Back in the day, people were like. Bloody awful. Well, yeah, that's right.
Exactly. And that's just, that's the thing. I think that Indiana Jones, the first three movies obviously are a representation of, I think, the best parts of filmmaking.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And they represent an era that really kind of was defined a lot of people's tastes.
I think also way to look at it is it's also reminiscent of the 30s and the 40s where the studios were in charge of everything. Mm-hmm. The studio gave you a producer. The studio gave you a director. The studio was the one that says, oh, you want to do all this? We'll give you the budget. But you basically got to justify it to me.
Yep.
So kind of like that, like Lucas. It's like, I got all the money. I got all the power. I'll do what I want. No one to say no to him. Well, that's what we really need. We need the studios to come back to be like, we need to make decent movies, not just give you a bunch of money and, hey, go nuts.
Yeah, we got to stop getting to the product and start making something that's worthwhile to see.
Absolutely.
I think that when you take a look at like when a filmmaker is hungry, you know, when you have like a Robert Rodriguez who makes like El Mariachi
and Desperado, or back to back,
John Carpenter and Assault on Precinct 13. That was a shoestring budget, but the movie was amazing.
Exactly. You know,
maybe
and
it's
from
time
that
to stop,
acorn.
Maybe it's time to stop making new Indiana Jones movies and just making new movies.
I completely agree.
And new heroes. Bret said it perfectly.
I think that's it. I mean,
I love the Indiana Jones movies, but it's time to take what you love about those movies, what you love about Star Wars, what you love about Indiana Jones, but go in a new direction.
Absolutely.
Create new characters.
Yep. New mythologies.
I like it.
There was the new Mad Max movie that came out.
That was
Fury
good.
Road.
That was decent,
exceptionally
yeah.
good. Mm-hmm. But there was talk initially.
I still couldn't understand what Tom Hardy was saying.
there was talk initially when that movie was well before the movie came out that they're going to make another one, and they wanted to use Mel Gibson before he had his little rant episode, where he wanted to use an old Mel Gibson, kind of passing the torch to the next Road Warrior kind of a situation. That was the original idea for Fury Road.
Yeah,
but once they were like, okay, Mel's no longer in the story, they were forced to go with a completely different story.
Yeah.
And I think that's another problem with Hollywood is Hollywood, they've run out of ideas.
Yeah.
They're starting to rehash. And
it's not that they're running out of ideas, it's they're afraid to produce the
new ideas.
It's
either way, they're rehashing old stuff that we've already loved so much that it's no, don't remake a movie just because you can.
It's part of it is also it's trackable. Like they actually want to have a product that it's like Coca-Cola. Okay, Coca-Cola's been around so damn long that nobody can ever remember when they didn't have Coca-Cola. You know, it's a product, and that's kind of the way that they're treating these movies is that they're creating a product, and they're not interested in how good the product is. They just slap a label on it and they say buy. You know. That's unfortunate.
It is unfortunate. I mean, I understand from your guys' point of view regarding the 80s, how that was the quintessential time for action movies to be made.
Predator.
Die Hard.
The Chopper.
But
it was the time of the action movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For me,
Kevin was here to do that good Schwarzenegger impersonation.
Ah, Kevin.
Yeah.
For me, it was the 60s, because the 60s, and you actually, you mentioned Doctor Who.
Yes.
Doctor Who is a prime example, because BBC had little to no budget for that show.
Yeah, it was a shoestring budget.
And yet it ran for so long, because they had decent people.
Good writing.
Decent writing.
Good writing.
And everyone was all like, okay, this is what we have to work with. Let's make it work.
That was the same thing with Dark Shadows. I mean, it was a soap opera at 5 o'clock in the afternoon for children. It was, you know, the sets sets would fall over.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Actors who were killed off in one scene would walk on to the scene the next time
with a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
They would use lighting equipment as props.
People would flub their lines, but still, you know, it's just like the imagination and the ideas that came into that show.
I mean, you watch the show and like they'd have an airy lighting kit as a prop.
Right.
This is a rifle now.
I think you mentioned John Pertwee. I started watching Doctor Who when Tom Baker was on.
Oh, so did I.
Yeah. Yep.
And I was luckily able, to watch several episodes with John Pertwee, and then later on with Peter Davidson, Colin Baker, Sylvester McCoy. But the thing that got me with Tom Baker was the fact that every scene was just so poorly done because of the shoestring budget. Yeah. Yet you saw the not necessarily enthusiasm, but the fact that they were so into it. They were like, listen, this is my role. I'm going to do everything I can to make
the acting and the writing. It was just like
exactly.
They would just draw you right in.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's one of the things, because you mentioned Transformers. Mm-hmm. I think Shia LaBeouf's acting in that movie was terrible.
Yep.
It was no life in it. A lot of no, Optimus! A lot of that, but there's no...
Oh, fuck you, Sam.
You have absolutely no care for this character. You don't care if he lives. You don't care if he dies. You just like you get to the point where you're like, just kind of push yourself to the
side. Well, not only that, but like just the as if, and I use that as a term, of some of the action sequences where, like, you know, a human being would fall, like literally 100 feet and, like, you know, be caught by this robot hand. And, like,
Which is metal. So there's, you know, you got terminal velocity to take into account, and the robots are just, I've got you.
Or they'd be shaking around in this big, huge thing.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It was just absolutely like, oh my.
I like, Brad, save me, Optimus. Oh.
I've got you.
Ah.
Oh, shit.
Sorry.
But, yeah.
Yes.
And not only that, but, you know.
You got him all right, Prime.
I mean, the CGI, especially in the Transformers movies, were just over the top.
Over the top, yep.
It's just like, whoa, like right in your face. And, like, you couldn't see anything.
It was kind of like when, during the 50s, when 3D came out.
Oh, God.
It's like everything in a 3D movie had to be in your face. It's like it's this like is 3D. Every 5 seconds, this is why you're watching 3D, because it's 3D. And you get to the point, like,
the
I get
movie,
it.
House of Wax. You had a scene with a guy with a paddle
Vincent
ball.
Price, yeah.
Yeah, a guy with a paddle ball doing it at the...
redid that scene in
Friday the 13th.
Monsters versus Aliens.
They also redid that scene in Harvey Birdman, Attorney at Law.
Okay.
Where they had him watching a TV, you know, with the guy doing the paddle ball. Yep, here he comes right at you. Up, we're going to throw stuff at the screen. Up, there we go, there we go. Talking in a really bad British accent. Say no more, know what I mean? Nudge, nudge.
Wink, wink.
No, it's as good as a wink to a blind bat.
Indy, Henry, follow me. I know the way. Ha!
Got lost in his own museum, huh?
Uh-huh.
After you, Junior.
Yes, sir. Ha!
On behalf of Jamie, Andrew, Wayne, and myself, thank you for listening to The Mental Suppository. Until next week, this is Brett Hurley saying...
I knew I'd disturb you.
The Mental Suppository has been produced by Brett Herholtz and Jamie Billings and distributed by M The Media Project. Theme music generously donated by Mr. B The Gentleman Rhymer. Visit his webpage at gentlemanrhymer.com. We would love to hear from our fans. Email us at mentalsuppository@gmail.com.